controversy.
Now, if any of you sons of bitches got anything else to say, now's the fucking time.
Hey, everybody, Jim and Sam are here. It's time to celebrate the moment. I feel it in my soul. It's written in my bones so deeply. I wanna lose control. So turn it up a little more and laugh along with me. The show is about to begin. Series 103. Yeah! So get ready, yeah. I'm so ready. Like 1, 2, 3.
Getting to the bottom of some stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just investigating.
Working out some stuff before the program begins.
A little stuff. I see.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Welcome.
Hello.
Happy Wacky Wednesday.
Yes. I love Wednesdays.
You do?
Yeah.
Hump day.
Because my, no, it's not even. Technically, Tuesday afternoon is our hump day. We're done.
Hours, but I like to be relatable to the people.
No. Fuck them. Fuck them. Wednesday is my, Fat Black Show at 7. I love doing that. I'm done early. And it's UFC. Wednesday's a great day. I don't have to go to the gym. I enjoy Wednesdays.
Yeah.
Non-gym days are always
non-gym
great.
Non-gym days are fun.
Yeah. What a pretzel-eating fat pig I've turned into.
Is that right?
Every night at the cellar, shoving pretzel rods into my face.
More than one.
The whole basket. A basket of pretzel rods. Little fat twat.
Those are for the table. Those are supposed to be for the table.
Yeah, but if I'm the only one at the table, they are.
Then they're gone.
Yes, they are. Very good.
You eat them a lot?
They gave them. I was there over the weekend. I was just chatting with Esty, and they brought these pretzel rods, and they were warm. Like, they had warmed the basket, and that's all she wrote.
Yeah.
Warmed pretzel rods.
Esty tried to get one. You turned into Chris Farley on SNL. Lay off me. I'm starving.
No, I like when she eats them because I feel like less of a slob, but I can get somebody else to dip in. I feel like, oh, I'm not eating the whole basket, but I really am.
Yeah.
I realize this is old lady talk.
Okay.
I'm like somebody's aunt.
You get
coming
fat
in.
From pretzels.
I ate too many of these little desserts. Nobody
not even desserts. Pretzels.
Pretzels.
It's like the least entertaining I'm letting myself go food.
That's what somebody's old aunt, some bitty old aunt does. Comes down on the radio and complains about what she ate. Oh, I knew I shouldn't have, but I treated myself. Especially, who fucking cares, Jim?
No one. And especially because pretzels... Pretzels are the snack that fat people eat when they're losing weight.
Yes, that's exactly. Yeah, they really are. But
they're not cooked in grease.
I love them.
Yeah,
I love them. And matzah, holy shit!
You love eating matzah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have some lightly salted matzah and soup. Nothing better.
I mean, there's so many things better.
Spray
than
butter,
unleavened bread and soup.
I eat lightly salted matzah with spray butter and some homemade soup.
That's. I mean. It's like what Oliver Twist ate.
Good for him. He wasn't fat.
Like, it's one step away from eating gruel, and you're like, there's nothing better than this.
I enjoyed it very much.
Yeah, but there's so many better things.
Yeah, but not like, yeah, I guess.
My fiance takes those matzah crackers and puts fa qua on them.
What is fa qua?
It's like goose liver.
Oh,
fagua.
Wait, is it fagua? Are we saying
no? It's fag. It's frog. Fagua.
We're saying it wrong.
Fagua.
Troy, what is it?
Fagua.
Fagua.
Wait, fagua. Oh, I think even that's wrong. What is
that's
goose
wrong.
Liver? We're all saying
we're
it wrong.
Fagua.
Duck liver.
Fagua.
No, it's goose liver. Yeah, it's
It's foie gras.
Foie gras.
Foie gras.
Say it again. Say it again in your inimitable way, Travis.
Foie gras.
Foie gras.
Foie gras.
Foie gras. Foie gras. Foie
gras.
Is it F O I E G R A S?
Huh?
F O I E G R A S.
Yeah.
Foie gras.
Yes.
Yeah.
Foie gras.
Yes. Pretty sure it's foie gras.
Yeah, we're all fucking idiots. None of us knew. I've heard it a thousand times because
yeah. But she likes it on the matzo crackers, which I can't understand. But
what does she like?
Yeah, it's good.
Foie gras.
I mean, I just we're trying to make fun of Troy for not pronouncing it.
But none of you guys could do it.
I couldn't shit on him.
Yeah.
And I've seen it ordered. Like whenever my girlfriend would order it, I would always tell the person she only likes this because it hurts the goose. She thinks it's funny the way they make it, and I shamed her out of getting it.
Your lady just eats that as a snack, Troy?
Yeah.
Like you just—it's not bad. Have you tried it?
But you just got like foie gras in the house.
She sometimes will do like she just did some event over the weekend and they had it and there was extra and she brought it home and then she was eating it yesterday.
Yo, you guys mind if I bring this foie gras home?
And the cat loves it. Toots loves it.
You've some foie gras?
Oh yeah.
What a fucking snooty cat. He's eating foie gras.
Toots is well taken care of.
Yeah. He loves. I love sweet potato and salmon. So
have
he
some
had
goddamn yum, bitch.
Yeah, I ate sweet potato and salmon yesterday. It's fucking awesome. Mr. Toots is the shit. Mr. Toots would love my fucking dinners. Yeah, it's actually
Mr.
not
Toots
bad.
Mr. Toots is sitting there listening to the radio. He's right. There's nothing better.
I can't fucking eat it, though, because it's so cruel. Like, it's unreasonably cruel the way they make it.
Yeah, but don't they fatten up the livers or whatever?
Just, yeah, like, and they shove tubes down their throat. Like, it's all kind of shitty, but that's, like, unreasonable just for that. But when I've had it, it is tasty.
Yeah. I just got an air fryer. I'm trying to master the air fryer.
I have one. We haven't used it yet. Do you?
I haven't mastered it yet.
Do you like it so far?
So far, it's cool.
Jonathan gave us one for Christmas, and we haven't used it yet.
I got the dual basket.
Nice.
Because I can't just, you know.
You're all about that.
Well, yeah, I had to go all the way. But I have to spend some more time. Like, I tried to make some chicken tenders, but, like, the chicken was good. But I put, like, a lot of flour on it for the coating and the breading and stuff. And when it came out, it was still, like, the flour was still dusty. It hadn't turned into...
Right. Because
they were from scratch. They weren't, like, frozen chicken tenders that you heat up. So I still got to figure some things out.
You just play around with it.
Yeah.
We have a regular Cuisinart one. It's not...
Yeah, I got that Ninja Double. The Ninja Double basket. That's what I got.
But you still have to put the flour and stuff on it to get it crispy, right?
But you can also get frozen chicken tenders. Like, you can get stuff that you could... Like, there's a lot of food now that is specifically made for deep... For air fryers, yeah.
Every time I think of the air fryer, I just think of Tim Dillon doing some offhanded funny thing talking about how every fat person says an air fryer saved their life, which I think is so... I can't think of my air fryer without thinking of it. I haven't used it yet. We just look at it.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, I've only taken it for a test run. But, yeah, and it was okay. The cleaning was easy.
It is.
But I'll have to just wait until I become the master.
What can you put in there without, like, I don't want to put the breaded stuff because that's the fat. Like,
well, you can also, like, on that one, you can do all kinds of stuff. You can bake and broil and you can make, like, dishes with, like, you know, potato. Like, you can mix up chicken without breading on it and mix it in with like vegetables and make almost like a stir fry type of thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, you don't have to make stuff that you would traditionally make in a deep fryer in the air fryer.
We don't like your giggling.
What's the giggling about?
Yeah, what is
my
your
wife
kittering?
Says you're closest.
First
to,
of all,
to pronouncing foie gras.
Tell your wife.
Jim is the word. Or Troy is the word.
Wait, foie gras?
You're the closest.
Foie gras.
Isn't it foie gras or foie gras?
Foie gras.
Foie gras. It's not foie gras.
Oh.
It's foie gras, I think.
No, because you don't pronounce the R in France.
France. France?
France is how you say it. You
go, foie gras.
Pays. France.
How does she say to say it?
I don't know.
I think it's
on text.
Ask her to write it phonetically. Is it foie gras or foie gras? I think it's...
And by the way, that's
foie gras. I think.
For the record, Montreal French
that's
is
dirty
not.
French.
It's
not,
dirty.
It's not French. French.
But she had to hear that shit growing up, so she probably knows how to say it.
Sure. See if there's a pronunciation on YouTube.
It's not France. France.
No.
Lisa had. Does she speak French or no?
Yeah.
When I was up there, I spent a lot of time up there, and I was.
She
like,
speaks French, but Travis speaks Greek.
You bet he does. When you're fucking an hour from Montreal, like there's some nice places and little resorts and stuff to go up there, little hotels, but they literally won't acknowledge English. In some of these pharmacies.
Oh, yeah, they get mad.
Jean Coutu Pharmacy.
There's a whole movement to just
Pharmaprix.
Completely get rid of the English language.
I mean, they're such fucking. Yeah. You know what they are? They're tryhards.
You think so?
The people who only speak French are fucking tryhards.
Uh-huh.
We want to get rid of English. Like, your only reason you're not being invaded is nothing to do with France. It's because of your downstairs neighbor. No one fucks with you.
Give us our props.
Because of your downstairs neighbors.
Give us our props.
That's it.
And stop with the poutine. We have disco fries, too. It's not a national dish. We have disco fries in every diner in Jersey.
Does she like the French or no?
Does she like the French?
Does she like? Does she like it?
No.
I'm interviewing Lisa through Travis' the phone. Yeah. But I want
to
know.
I mean, you can just talk to her.
She had to listen to that shit for her whole life.
No, she hates it.
Yeah. You learn it because you have to learn
she
a little bit.
She loves that poutine, though.
Yeah.
Does she understand it's the same thing as disco fries?
No, she's stupid.
She is? Yeah.
Why you, here's what I don't like. He whispered it, but into the mic. It's still.
I think it was for effect.
Yes.
You got me.
Okay, how to pronounce foie gras. I think I said it real good that time.
Foie gras. It's, there's an R in it.
You said it good too.
Foie gras.
Foie gras.
What is up, guys? Bonjour. This is Julien, the Frenchman who makes.
Could you not find a 9-minute video? Just.
No, this is a good one.
This is good. I like
Julien the Frenchman.
Yeah. I'm just glad that he's giving himself some props.
I don't want to watch. This is a cookie video. Please.
Here we go. No, right here. Here. Okay. Here.
Believe we are looking at how to pronounce with the typical French pronunciation foie gras.
You name it. Yeah. Foie gras.
Yeah, I've heard it foie gras. Foie gras, yeah.
Troy said fugu.
Yeah.
I said that.
But I didn't even realize it at first how to say it, and I've said it a lot, so it's a fucking rough one. It's a shit word.
Troy pronounced it like that dog at the end of Family Ties. Sit, Ubu, sit.
Good dog.
Oof.
Yeah. Where do they want to... I forget where I was where they wanted to... No one... They acted like they didn't understand English. It's like, hey, fucking...
They knew,
twat,
though, right?
You understand every word I'm saying. I'm looking for eye drops.
Twit.
Stop trying to give yourself culture because...
You should have come to the studio.
They felt guilty because they're fucking... You know why they felt guilty?
Why?
Because they're up there living the lap of luxury due to the protection afforded them by their, yes, granted, ignorant big brother downstairs. That's exactly what
There's
it is.
There's a big galoot that lives downstairs.
There's a giant, thick-fisted mob henchman that lives downstairs.
Yeah.
Who keeps anyone from fucking with their apartment. And they kind of, they want to distance themselves from their neighbor,
That's
cousin.
Right.
But yet, if shit went down, first guy they'd knock on the door would be their fucking big galoot cousin downstairs.
I don't know him. I don't know. But
yeah, until some fucking some Chechenian neighbors move in, and then they're like, "We'll talk to our cousin."
Here's what it is: when their nerdy friends come over, they go, "Oh no, don't talk to him. Don't talk to my brother." But when they're about to get shoved into a locker, guess who stops it?
The big galoot.
We're the galoots.
The big galoot downstairs.
That's right.
Where are you going, Trey?
For some reason,
fromage.
Fromage.
Are you saying like the U.S. is like the Matt Biggins and I'm kind of like Canada?
No, because he's not affording you protection.
Biggins to protect you and hold you?
He doesn't protect you. He wants to smash you.
No, I mean, your weird like negging of Matt Biggins is getting to a point where it's making him very uncomfortable. And when Matt Biggins gets uncomfortable, he hurts people. It's very warm. Hey, Troy, on your way back, why don't you... dump the AC down. All
you
the
probably
way down.
Shouldn't, because the next jostle might be all the way up as opposed to a little up.
As punishment?
No, just because it's cold.
Oh.
What are you
Brian doing? In Belvedere. Belvedere, is that a place?
Mister.
That's what
he said.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's about 90 miles west of Chicago.
Oh.
I commute from the burbs out here to teach, and Mr. Montone knows me as teacher Brian. I've emailed you guys a ton, and I think the world of you guys. It's great to talk to you.
Shout out to you, Brian.
I just want to give you guys some great air fryer advice. You will never use the microwave to heat something up again.
Sick.
It's unbelievable on fried items that you bring home from the restaurant. It's incredible. Ooh. On pizza. And even be a Chicago native, I'm not a deep dish guy, but that you get a good thin pizza with a lot of cheese and a lot of stuff on it, you will believe how crispy it makes it the next day. It's unbelievable.
I'll try that.
You'll never reheat in a microwave again.
But how long does it take? Because if it acts like an oven, then it's like the microwave is just a speed thing. Is the air fryer faster than the oven?
You know, Jim, it felt like it. It felt like it did it. And you just got to monitor your numbers. You know, Jim, it sounds like Sam's done a little bit more with it. Or a dab a little bit more. But you just got to monitor it. I'm always watching the plug to make sure I don't overheat it or burn it. And you really just find it kind of, remember how when microwaves were first around, we kind of just gauged how we put stuff in there so we didn't blow up something or something like that. It's kind of that same thing. I find myself gauging it, watching it. The time might be a little off. If I brought it out of the fridge, I watch the time a little bit. If it's, you know, sat out a little bit, watch the time a little bit. But you, it's kind of a touch and go thing. But
okay.
I cannot believe how good stuff is coming out of it. I really can't.
Pause. Pull out the basket. Look inside. Okay, put it back.
We should use it. Yeah, we got it. It was a great gift by Jonathan and his wife. So
you bet.
Thanks, man. We'll use it.
Yeah.
She cooks at least. I don't fucking touch the oven. I told you when she came, literally the cardboard was in the oven, and now at least the oven gets used.
That's great.
Yeah.
Look at you, living a life.
Yeah, that's great.
Living a life. Got a lady cooking for you. That's incredible.
And I usually eat my microwavable whole 30 meals, but still.
I wonder if you can do whole 30 in an air fryer. Probably not because of the container.
Oh, maybe you put it on a plate.
Is your air fryer big enough to put a plate in there, or maybe you just put it in something else?
Oh, I don't know.
Sure, you can figure it out.
Yeah.
Al in Florida. What's up, Al?
Good morning, gentlemen.
Hi, Al.
Jimmy, I got the perfect snack for you. You get some dry chow mein noodles and dip them in the Chinese hot mustard. You'll go nuts.
I'll be honest. Chinese hot mustard is the most underrated thing on the planet.
I mean, you're not even just limiting it to food or even condiments. You're saying of everything.
It's not as good as an ass on your face.
Right.
But it's better than a ripe vag.
Wow.
I put it in between a ripe vag and an ass on my face.
So if
that's how,
like,
good Chinese mustard is.
I'll sit on your face, but you can only have
isolate
the front.
That.
Or you can have some of this hot honey mustard from China.
Not honey mustard.
No.
No. Chinese mustard.
Chinese hot mustard.
Hot mustard. When you get that, you dip your egg roll into it. Do you eat egg rolls or no?
Yeah, I'll eat an egg roll, but I won't eat mustard.
But the duck sauce is good. Duck sauce is very overrated. That Chinese hot mustard is fucking phenomenal. They usually have it. Some Asian places don't have it. Like, you'll expect them to have it, and they don't have it. But yeah, those chow mein noodles and that fucking Chinese mustard, I can eat that without even a meal.
I bet egg rolls would be good out of the air fryer.
Maybe.
Like, either reheated or like the frozen egg rolls from Target. Target. Then I think, or how would you say it in French? Touget?
No, that was a Florentine joke when we first started. Like, way back, you know, about what a cheap date he was. Mm-hmm. Like, he's taking this girl, she goes, "Yeah, taking me to a nice restaurant?" "Yeah, it's a French place called Roy Roger's." Roy Roger. And I can't, 32 years later, I cannot pass a Roy Rogers without thinking of Florentine.
That's amazing.
It's weird how a joke or something somebody says.
Same thing with Applebee's, right?
Applebee's. You just can't. Certain things you can't.
Right.
It's never leaving.
It's now associated.
I will never think Roy Rogers.
Yeah.
Roy Rogers.
As Roy Rogers is going out of business, there's like two left. But
oh,
those
they are,
two.
Yeah. Roy
if
Rogers.
You pass those two, yeah.
It is plummeting, isn't it?
Yeah, it's real tough to find a Roy Roger.
Yeah. I've seen many Roy Rogers.
Back in the day?
Yeah.
I used to love him.
Yeah, I think I liked him too.
Aaron in Illinois. What's up, Aaron?
There's a few.
Okay, there's a...
Hey, guys.
Yeah, there's a handful.
Hey, bacon in the air fryer is like the absolute best.
Better than on a skillet?
Way better than on the skillet. You know, my fiance tries to throw that shit in like the oven and stuff. And it's awesome.
It doesn't dry it out?
No, not at all, actually. Like, I love chewy bacon. And... like a regular or like a...
Don't turn them into bacon.
Never go back. And Jim, I would put like Brussels sprouts in there with some parm and some bacon, like put some, toss in some bacon grease. And that's not the most healthy thing, but
right.
If you're looking for veggies, it's not bad.
Yeah, and it's like saying I like broccoli dipped in kerosene. I don't want bacon. Brussels sprouts crispy are very good.
Yeah, especially if you put sugar all over them. They're still very healthy.
Yeah, I like a nice crispy Brussels.
Troy, you wouldn't put bacon in an air fryer?
Nothing's better than a skillet. That cast iron skillet.
Cast iron, that's how I make it.
Do you know how to use it, or does your
fiance
girl do it?
Does.
Yeah. You don't cook?
I'm not as good as... I mean, why even bother?
I can't
her?
Do it. Yeah, I guess so, but she's there.
Yeah, she's not on the ones and twos. Troy's not going to be in the kitchen, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They both have their skill sets. Yeah. Jim in Colorado. Oh. What's up, Jim?
Yeah, I just wanted to agree with that last caller. Cooking in an air fryer is very awesome.
It's very awesome.
So, amazing, sir. You must be. Do you advertise these for a living, sir?
I must say.
I'm a truck driver and I use it all the time.
I find it to be very awesome.
Do you travel with your air fryer?
I do. I'm a truck driver.
Oh, okay. So that was a dick question, I guess. Okay.
I thought it was appropriate.
But what I would say is, unless what you're cooking has specific air fryer instructions, you want to make sure you turn the temperature down about 30 degrees and the time down about 10 minutes, because that heater fan sits right on your food and it'll burn the shit out of it.
Okay, so you
try and cook it like oven directions.
How big is your sleeper in your truck? You must have some room back there if you have an air fryer.
Where?
I do. It's not a giant sleeper with a shower and toilet.
Right.
But it is the typical larger sleeper.
Would you consider 70, your
72 inches?
Would you consider your sleeper to be awesome or very awesome?
I have a super twin bed, and I have a lot of storage space underneath the bunk.
So I'd say very awesome.
Do you have a kitchen area, like those little kitchen, like a little seating kitchen area?
No, I do a lot. The only thing I cook in my truck is my air fryer, but I do have a frying pan and a stove, and I do all that cooking outside on my trailer.
What a life.
That's a life, yeah. But
do you enjoy it, dude? Do you enjoy life?
I don't live that way.
I'm not asking.
I've been driving for 23 years. I love it.
Do you have a family?
And I listen to y'all every day.
Do you have a family?
I do, but my kids are all grown up and gone.
It's nice to get away, isn't it?
So
when I've seen
for
those
4 days, and on the third day, my wife's asking me, "You're still here?" So, you know, we have a great marriage.
As you know, I'm fascinated by 18-wheelers, like, and those giant sleep. That's too. We're looking at a video of a sleeper truck.
That rules.
That looks almost too big to drive. Like, I mean, one that you could drive anywhere. That looks almost like a specialty one for a showroom. It doesn't look practical.
You could drive anywhere.
You can't. I mean, like, that looks like it would be very hard to get around in Manhattan. I'm sure you could if you had to.
Yeah.
Trying to drive a sleeper around Manhattan?
Well,
they drive those in, yeah.
Yeah, but why would you need to drive it around Manhattan? Like, you want to drive it to work?
No, I'm looking at the ones that you can kind of drive anywhere, as opposed to a specialty one that looks like it was just made.
Highway driving.
That was like made more to show off than to actually be practical.
That's nice, though.
That's fucking amazing. Thanks for the call, man. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, Jim.
Yeah, I can watch. I've watched videos of these things. There's one guy that does all these truck, he interviews the people that have them, but then he didn't show the bed area. I'm like, what the fuck you doing, dude?
Well, what about the people that turn their vans into, like,
yeah,
do you feel the same way about that? Like Tom Green in the pandemic, he got a little freaked out,
yeah,
and wanted to just live on the road, but he had this amazing van that he turned into, like, where he slept. He turned it into a cool podcast and music studio. Like, it was pretty amazing what he just did by himself building it.
No, these are different, man. Like, these are so big. Like, vans are nice, too.
It's almost like a tour bus, this.
This is like a tour bus thing, in a way.
Oh, and, look at that TV.
It looks safe.
I wonder if they got Peacock.
It looks safe, in a way. Like, you know, you can have a big rifle back in this thing and fuck a dog. Like, a van just seems more claustrophobic than this. This is...
People got dogs in vans.
You do, but this just seems more claustrophobic than this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's Tom Green's.
That's great.
I thought that was from the Green Tom show.
No. This is the Tom Green show.
Oh.
Wow, that's a fucking nice...
It's my favorite show.
That is nice. And there's a shower and a bath. That literally looks like the front of a plane.
Yeah, it does.
With where the bathroom is and...
Yeah, I would hang. Yeah. That would be a good way to travel. Except, I'd still be paranoid parking it in places and going to sleep. Like, I'd still, even though you lock the door and everything, it's just, you'd be worried. Even on either on the side of the road or truck stops or whatever, it seems frightening.
Well, then again, if you have a pistol with you, you can't if you're in different states, because every state has different gun laws. So you can't even have a. If you have a pistol with you, you're fine. But if you have a dog. I've seen sometimes where guys will keep their dogs outside the truck. I guess on a hot night, if the dog, like, they could leave their window open.
Yeah.
But yeah, it does seem a little scary.
Seems a little scary.
But then when you drive into a rest area and you see 30 trucks, like, there's so many that they're like...
And you probably get used to it.
You get used to it.
You get used to it pretty quick.
Yeah. It seems like a lonely life, but also kind of fun. If you like it, it's probably a great way to live. Especially if you're like in like Utah or the Midwest, where it's all these 70-mile-an-hour open giant highways. It's not like New York or fucking Jersey.
Plus, you get to go like drive around where the mountains and stuff are. You know how great that would be? I'd be a truck driver.
Straight driving would be nice. Yeah, Carl Malone from the Utah Jazz owns one of these. Like, I don't know how nice it is, but he loves big trucks.
Yeah.
Just for recreational driving, I think.
Just to have it.
Yeah.
That's awesome. The mailman, Carl Malone?
Yeah, it'd be him, yeah.
He had some problems, huh?
Did he?
I think Carl Malone had some big controversies.
Now you're thinking of Jimmy Kimmel as Carl Malone.
Yeah.
Did he have problems? I never remember Carl Malone having problems.
Yeah, I think there were some. I think there are reasons why he doesn't really do interviews or anything anymore.
Oh, I'm not paid attention.
I think there were controversies.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Statutory rape allegations.
Oh.
Yeah.
From when?
Well, they resurfaced last year because this year because the All Star game was in Utah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's right. I didn't really see him around.
Yeah. No. He doesn't really do stuff.
I never heard that.
Huh. Jen in Indiana, what's up, Jen?
Hey guys, I tried to call yesterday, but I had to go into school.
Oh.
So we use our air fryer basically for everything. You can almost everything has air fryer directions now. But if you
That's
Google,
sick.
If something doesn't, you can Google it. What do you need? How long do you need to put this in the air fryer for?
Wait, you can Google how long to put something in the air fryer and it will come up?
Yep, yep, yeah. If it does not have air fryer directions, Google. Like, so how nice. Long should I put this in the air fryer? And it'll tell you exactly the temp and exactly how long.
Do you know why? And I didn't know. We had the air fryer. I have not used it yet, but I couldn't find instructions printed around the house. I didn't even think to go. If you Google, like, how long to cook it for, you can find those results.
Yep. What size did you get? Did you get a small one or a big one?
Average size Cuisinart. We can look it up, Troy. I don't know.
Cuisinart.
Wait, if I look on Google, okay. Can I find how big a Cuisinart is, too?
Yeah, just Google like the time and temperature. That's it.
The time right now it's 8:30. How is that going to help me?
30 minutes past the hour. Womp, 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 womp.
No, the time that you need something. It doesn't matter the size of the air fryer. I'm just saying, if you bought a small one and you love it, you're going to be mad because you're going to want the bigger one.
Oh yeah, believe. Hold on a second.
Yeah, whoa.
The
funny train's about to start rolling.
Yeah.
Because it means air fryer, it's an air fryer. So like,
wait, what? Air fryer means air fryer? Hold on a minute. You just went a little level too deep for me.
Anything you would,
poor Jen.
Anything you would fry, you can put
my brain.
In air fryer, it tastes, yeah, your brain. If you're my dad, you fry your brain. So, but yeah, it's. Tastes like a fryer, air fryer. Does.
I think we had the one that's like 150 or 179, so two
she
levels.
She just had mentioned that when you make stuff in the air fryer, it tastes like an air fryer.
Oh, does it taste like it's been air fried, Jen?
It tastes like fried.
Oh.
It tastes like stuff that's fried.
But it's an air fryer.
It does.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'll have to explore. I have not used mine. I think ours is like one.
How are you going to find anything out, though, Jim?
Yeah, but if they didn't, I don't have all this stuff in the instruction booklet. What am I supposed to do?
Yeah, you just Google it.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Jen.
No problem. Bye, guys.
Bye-bye. A nice lady.
Jen is a wonderful listener.
She is, yeah.
She's really supportive.
Yeah. Explaining Google.
You know you could Google at?
What?
I never even thought.
I don't know which one is ours.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, I mean, I know less than you.
Say that again. I'm a man who's been steeped in knowledge.
Yeah, you are.
Yeah, it's silver.
Ray in Georgia.
Hey guys, I've been driving a truck about 30 years or so.
Just pull over.
Yeah, it's a lot of gas.
I know, I'm fucking exhausted.
Must be tired.
Those gigantic sleeper trucks run about $280,000.
Can you drive them? Like, if you had to go into Boston with an 18-wheeler, how do you take a giant? You can't do it, right?
You just throw a Dropkick Murphy's logo on the side. They'll let you in wherever.
A lot of those guys that pull those big sleeper trucks haul jet engines to the airports.
Oh.
So they can make it in and out. A lot of that's a specialty thing.
So
it's like an apartment on wheels, basically.
When are you driving to Boston in a sleeper?
If you have a tractor trailer and there's something to be shipped from Texas?
Yeah, I used to go there all the time downtown Boston with a 53-foot trailer.
Well, not me, but I'm saying the proverbial, any person who would drive, who has a sleeper truck, you own it. If your load is to pick up in Texas and drive it to Boston.
You're looking at it going like, oh, that would be cool to have. And then you go, but I couldn't drive to Boston.
Well, I'm using an example because I've been using New York. What if it's a city that's smaller,
right?
That you need an 18-wheeler to get in? What do you do with these giant sleeper
cabs? A lot of times you take them to another trucking facility and they'll put it on a smaller truck.
Whoa, watch the language.
And wait, and you drive it in or they'll drive it in?
Yeah, you drive it to like a terminal and then you offload it to another smaller truck and then that company will take it into Boston.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Yeah. They'll use your truck to get it from point A to almost point B and then a smaller truck. Okay.
Yeah, they drop off the back.
Yeah, put on maybe like a U-Haul type truck to go into the city. There's places in the city that trucks are restricted from.
They got it all figured out.
I've been to Jamaica. I've been to Queens in one, but I almost like tore a bunch of shit up going in there.
That seems like whenever I see a fucking 18-wheeler in the city, I'm like, what the fuck are you doing?
I see them all the time on Broadway.
It's insane that they actually drive those in New York.
And they drive them like they're nothing. Like they are not concerned at all. Well, I'm making this turn.
Oh, they make the turn. There's people in the way. They don't care. They're like, people are going to move.
Yeah. Guess what? Guess what I am? A giant truck.
But once in a while, some stupid asshole, when they're trying to make those wide berth rights, will pull up in between them and the curb and not realizing the guy's making a turn. Mm-hmm. And then the truck can't turn because he's going to rip the car. So then they're just stuck till the idiot car backs up or goes around him.
I would love it if you did retire, get a truck for a lot of reasons.
Yes.
And then your first day out with the truck, just tin can the roof right off.
I wouldn't get a truck. I'm not delivering pallets of shit. I would just want the actual...
Just the sleeper.
Oh, the sleeper, yeah. Drive around.
So why not just get an RV? Like JB.
Yeah, RVs are nice. But I don't really
need like a sleeper truck.
I guess not. Yeah, an RV would be it. RVs are better.
Yeah.
Yeah, hopefully for the same reason. every day I come home, I have to hear the vacuum cleaner going.
Dear Ndugu.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. Yeah.
That RV life could be fun.
It could be fun.
No, it would be fun for a little while. You know how boring that is when you have to fucking deal with these other zilches putting out their lawn chairs?
Well, you don't
where are you coming from?
No,
fuck you.
That would be the worst part of RVing is RV culture.
Yeah.
Like, you would have to, like, make a commitment that you're not hanging with these RV people. Because I wouldn't want to hang.
You know, it's cool when you go down in Malibu, you go into Santa Monica,
mm-hmm.
they have like RVs just parked on the road. I could do that.
Yeah.
Just park off the side of the road, have the ocean as the view.
Those
yeah.
are homeless people.
No, they're not. They're in really nice RVs.
They got RVs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a home.
Yeah, they're living in them. They're
right.
just surfer people.
Jim would love it until the first time he's got to like empty the shitter.
Shitter's full.
That would be the worst. I wouldn't even empty it. I would just get like a special shit sneaker and I would keep stepping on it and mushing it down like it was, I was making a neutron star.
Shitter's full, honey. Yeah. Yeah, I could see RV life being fun. Like, you know, for like when you're retired or when your kids are older or whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, I probably want to go with somebody who I actually liked and then not have to hang out with any of the other RV people because they'd be lonely and they'd talk your ear off.
It's boring in an RV because the traveling is great when you get to you have a destination, you spend some hours, but the idea of everybody just sitting in there all day and probably, that would suck.
Oh, it'd be great because you could watch weird shows online and just go nuts.
She's at home though.
But when you're at home, you're not stuck. You're not in a bubble. You haven't created a bubble around yourself. You can just leave the house and you're fine.
Did RV sales, I wonder, did they go up during the pandemic? Did people buy them and go, fuck it, and just, we were all in this weird cartoon world?
I think they did. I think there were people that decided to do that.
Yeah, I see what you mean, Troy. Those pictures. That's the Pacific Go? Is that the
PCH?
Pacific Coast Highway, yeah.
Yeah, PCH.
Going right into Santa Monica over here.
I've gone into some houses along there. Like, Jonathan's got friends there. Oh my God, are they nice fucking places.
Yeah, that was my plan when I was out there in LA. I was going to drive up the Pacific Coast Highway because I had a few hours. But then I got there and the traffic was so bad, I just stayed for 20 minutes and left.
Isn't that where Caitlin rear-ended that person? I think that was the Pacific Coast Highway.
Caitlin didn't rear-end anybody.
You're right, Bruce?
Yeah, that guy doesn't...
That was Caitlin.
No, that was Bruce. I remember because the whole thing was that, like...
Oh.
You never found out, like... There was never any real penalty. So you're like, yeah, that must have been Bruce. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know who did that.
Okay. Yeah, I think it was the Pacific Coast Highway.
Yeah. Yeah, it was. I bet there are a lot of accidents that happen there because people are looking out on the water.
Looking at the fucking ocean.
Yeah.
Slow driving fucking idiots.
Yeah.
Look, water. This thing they're plowing into a family of eight.
Well, I'm sure I was looking at the water, you know, because
yeah.
You water. Look, water.
Yeah, water. It is very nice there, though. When you're sitting there and looking at the beach, I mean the water from back someone's backyard, you're like, this is a nice way to live.
Yeah, from the backyard. Yeah, if you had a house there. Oh, I was wondering why the phones were going crazy all of a sudden. It's truckers.
Well, of course.
The truckers love it.
The truckers love when we talk about trucks, but I love talking about, I can talk about trucks every day. I know. I love them. I love the.
I'm fascinated by your fascination.
With trucks.
With trucks.
It's like a little kid.
Hey, what kind of sleeper you have?
But it's such a such a different kind of cool. I know there's a lot of hard work what comes with it, and traffic and shit roads and loneliness and bad eating, but it does, there on the surface it seems like if you have a great sleeper truck, it's just freedom.
Like yeah. This all started
freedom
because somebody called in about an air fryer and Jim was like,
put that in the back of the truck.
Well, yeah, but you can't have an air fryer on your regular, what are you going to hold it in your lap?
Yeah, come on.
Tell me all about your sleeper.
Sure.
Also, like, you have, your lifestyle is as much freedom as one could possibly get, and you're still on that quest.
But I couldn't, you know what, I couldn't, it's more free than what they do, because they have to be places, they have to drive, I mean, that's a much harder life driving a truck.
Yeah, but you don't have to deal with bullshit while you're driving. Like, you might have to deal with bullshit once you get there, but, like, while you're driving, it's like that, we were talking about yesterday, when we had jobs, and, like, the best part
of
it. Oh, my,
what an interview he was. I know. I understand.
I don't want to finish my point. Not,
yeah, I know. I know. We had jobs.
And yeah.
And I said, go to the doctor. You don't look well. And he said, I can't. I'm eating wheatgrass.
We know what jobs you're talking about.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure. And I said, look what I got. A hell of an iPhone. And he coughed.
Don't define Steve Jobs by his sickness.
I'm not defining him by his lack of willingness to go and do something.
He invented the telephone.
Genius. He's a genius. But
he didn't go to doctor.
It's just crazy how brilliant someone could be.
He drank tea.
And so stupid.
The reality distortion field.
I guess so, yeah.
And he lived in it. Mike in Connecticut.
Hello, guys.
Hey, Mike.
Hello, Mike.
Hey, Jim. I'm going to be at the Bethlehem show, and I'm an over-road truck driver for the last 30 years, and I'll gladly let you play in my truck if that's what you want to do.
Oh my God!
This is the. By the way, this is the recording they play in court when my body is not found. When they just find one of my shoes. Yeah, that sounds great, Mike.
Driving, but you can explore the inside. It's nothing special. It's just a comfortable truck.
Oh Jesus Christ!
Sleeper truck.
Oh, I'd like to see it. Yeah, I'll be there. That's this month, May 19th in Bethlehem.
Oh boy!
Thanks, Mike. Yeah, come up and say hello after.
I will. I'll have the truck out in the parking lot.
All right. Oh boy! Thanks, buddy. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, man.
No. Get a look at the inside.
Yeah.
No, all the way inside.
All the way in the back.
All the way in the back.
Yeah.
No, right around the corner there, looking like De Niro at the end of Goodfellas. No. Oh, back there.
Door slams behind him.
What?
Yeah.
What?
Then he starts going over bits that I knew were a problem when I did them. Oh, no. This is the guy.
Dan in New Hampshire.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
Hi, Dan.
Hey, Dan.
I was going to call yesterday, but I couldn't get around to it.
Oh, man, I'm glad you clarified that. We were wondering. I was talking to Travis before Jim got here. I was like, what the fuck happened with Dan yesterday? I thought he was going to call.
Yeah, Travis thought you died, and Sam intelligently said he probably just didn't have time. And there you go, Sam.
Yeah.
You're vindicated.
Sorry. 2 points.
Sorry.
It's cool.
Yeah, but if you go to www.google.com, you can actually look up that convection ovens are actually the same as air fryers. So if you have a convection setting,
I've seen that there is, thank you, Dan, there are controversies that people claim that they're the same, but other people claim that they're not.
People just like air fryer. Maybe they like the name air fryer because it makes the word fry is in it and air. So you're like, it gets you thinking healthy.
Yeah.
No, it's healthy.
That's 100% right. People do think that it's.
Travis was going to snicker at me.
They're the same.
But different.
But still same.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Eric in Colorado. What's up, Eric?
Eric. Oh.
Hey, guys. Hey.
Are you friends with Dylan?
Yes, actually, I am.
So, I got the reference. Thank you. You guys like Marilyn Manson?
Yeah.
Violent video games?
Yes.
No, I do like violent video games. Not a fan of Marilyn Manson, though. But
oh God, what's wrong with your ears?
First off, as a truck driver, my dead hooker storage is 3. I have tried. But you guys were saying about RV sales during the pandemic, and I have a friend that sells RVs, and they pretty much tripled during the height of the pandemic, and now they're really bottoming out.
Of course.
They were saying prices are going to start coming down big time.
Oh, they haven't even come down yet. Wow, because stock is in the toilet.
No, they're not.
Of course it is. With the president we have, it stinks. Stock sucks right now.
You're saying there's a sticker on Wall Street of Joe Biden going, I did that.
It should be, yeah. Yeah.
It's a funny sticker, isn't it?
It is a funny sticker. Yeah. Just like the price of everything else is up. I mean, my boss just ordered some new trucks, and when he bought mine 4 years ago, it was $210,000, and now it's $235,000.
Oh, so they're higher. Okay.
Cars are still tough to get.
Well, but I mean, I don't have a big, huge, giant, fancy sleeper like some of these guys do. Mine's a little bit smaller, but still, it's. I mean, there's some of these trucks, even just basic is $250,000 for some of these trucks.
So basic.
Even more than that.
You're such a basic truck driver. Your truck is so basic. I don't want to go into that broke-ass truck. It's such a basic truck. You'll drive me across the border in that truck.
Still funny.
Oh, yeah. I'm still fighting extradition. They want to send me home.
Joel in Indiana.
Hey there.
Hey.
How's it going, guys?
Hey, buddy.
Hey, so we build RVs out here in Indiana, and there's a whole segment of RVs that is built for the people that don't want to be around other people. So
nice.
You get solar panels and batteries, and you just go out and get the hell away from everybody.
Yeah. I'm sure it's a fun life if that's what you want. It just seems to me like the appealing part of it is the part that we focus on, but then there's all that legwork and grunt work that would suck, and a lot of hours where you're fucking bored or you're in traffic or it's bad weather and you're driving and you're like, oh, shit.
You're just chilling, dude.
Nah. It's a big thing to drive.
You're not doing anything.
That's not a comfortable drive, I don't think.
You always have to pay attention.
You do, yeah.
You know?
Well, if you're driving, you just pull over.
You're driving a house.
Plus, don't forget, you get a big comfy seat when you drive.
Yeah.
Captain's chair.
You do. Those captain's chairs look pretty nice.
They look pretty nice.
But I wouldn't want something that wide to drive. I think that would be I drive an X6, which I lease.
Nice.
In the city sucks. But I don't drive it that much. You know, it's like the one thing I do. No fucking kids, so I always lease something I like driving. Mm-hmm. But it's a fat, wide car, and it's even annoying driving that once in a while. Like, I can't imagine something the size of a sleeper. I mean, I'm sorry, a fucking RV. Look at that. That's nice.
I'd love to get a tour bus and drive the Roberts Clan around in the tour bus.
Would you?
Yeah. Probably be a hindrance to the neighbors, but...
No. Yeah, tour bus. Is that a tour bus?
Yeah.
Wow.
RVs.
Is it technically an RV?
Luxury RVs.
Oh, my God. You don't need all those couches, though. What are you fucking... having a Puffs white party there?
Puffs.
Puffs. I won't keep finding his new name. I just won't.
Is he? Is
Diddy? I don't know what it
Brother
is.
Love?
Yeah, I just
remember
won't.
When he was Brother Love, and then Brother Love from WWE was like, yeah, no.
Yeah, I just won't.
That's trademarked.
Isn't he just Diddy?
I believe it was the D, the I, the D, the D, the Y, the D, the I, the D.
Yeah, I just can't.
Troy's getting upset.
He's arguing with someone.
No, it's Jen. She called back, and she doesn't want to tell you guys, but you're being assholes.
You know what? Let her tell us. We'll take the hit.
They want to talk to you.
Put her on hold.
We'll take the hit.
Hang on, Jen. Hang on. Okay.
All right.
Hi, Jen.
Which line is she on?
Oh, sorry.
No, that's okay. Yes. Is that 5?
5, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Hello, Jen.
Hey, Jen, you there?
Yes. You guys are being buttholes today, man. I got to go deal with 150 eighth graders. Don't give me a hard time.
Not at all.
We're not trying to be BHs.
No, not at all.
Okay, your other callers are being big assholes. What the hell?
The callers are.
Yeah, we didn't think because Jim, before the show, Jim had been complaining. He's like, I want information, but I checked the bottom of my shoes and it wasn't written there.
Yeah.
Where could I ever find it? And I was like, I have no fucking idea.
Yeah.
I can't tell you.
I had to.
You guys make my day every day. I love you. I'm just giving you a hard time.
Yeah, well, you actually got me to delete my Ask Jeeves app.
Yeah. All right.
Goodbye, Jen. Thank you.
Yeah. So much.
Bye.
You make my day before I have to teach these little shits. And all right, I love you.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you, Jen.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. You guys are being buttholes. I love the Heartland.
Yeah.
Charlie in Georgia. What's up, Charlie?
Not surfing.
Hey, what's up?
What's up, dude?
Hey, so my wife and I traveled in an RV over the pandemic. We had a 36-foot fifth wheel. And, Jim, you are absolutely correct that if you're traveling around the country in that thing and you don't have anything to do, you will get bored as fuck.
Yeah. I imagine that, like, the novelty of how fun it can be, it wears off after a while.
Yeah, so my wife and I both work remotely. So we were working through the whole pandemic.
Oh.
So that kind of cut down on everything, like Monday to Friday. And then during the weekends, we would go out and like hike and stuff like that. But if it were just us in that thing by ourselves for like 5 days, we probably...
You couldn't do 5 days?
We murdered each other.
You couldn't do 5 days?
That means every week. 5 days a week instead of working.
You mean five days a week, or you mean for 5 days?
No, for like 5 days, like Monday through Friday, if we weren't working and we were just sitting there staring at each other.
Do you like each other?
It would have been a problem.
But
what? I mean, what you gonna do? You gonna sit there and just stare at each other for you know, for 5 days?
Even working remotely seems tough. Even working remotely seems like a fucking a nightmare for 5 days in an RV with the same person. It seems crazy.
Well, we're both on, like, conference calls and stuff like that,
Shut up.
It wasn't bad, but...
Yeah.
We're looking at one now.
Oh, there's a helicopter on the roof of that one? That's the one you should have gotten, Charlie.
With a car pulled up next to it. These are nice RVs.
Well, we had a 36-foot fifth wheel, and it had, like, a...
You keep saying that.
It had, like, a washing machine and a king bed. I mean,
bro,
was,
I'm looking at one with a helicopter on the roof. Fridge. You're not going to impress
I'll
me.
I'll take a king bed over a helicopter.
Get bigger.
Yeah, Will Smith's extends.
Yeah, but that's probably, they probably stay parked though. They don't drive like that.
Right, and he's
they
got
stay
a,
parked for his, it's probably his film trailer.
And Will has a boxing gym on top just in case he meets any comedians. He has to stay in.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Is that Will's?
You know, another thing is you have to watch, the roads where you're driving those.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you go, it's not so bad out in the west, but in the northeast, those bridges are so low that you'll, you know, tin can it. But out west, it's so open out there that driving it is pretty easy.
Will does not have an RV. He has a tractor. He has a trailer, like for a tractor trailer. Like that's one of these giant.
Yeah, he's not in the driving section.
No. They actually just park the trailer and probably put the fucking, those things down and then extend it for him. Is it two stories?
It's a suite on wheels. Yeah, it's two stories.
It probably takes them a day to get that set up. Like, he's coming in on Tuesday. By Monday, they probably park that, extend it, strengthen it. And
that's right.
Whatever you gotta, however you gotta brace the fucking upper floors.
You don't drive around in it.
That's the way to live.
On a set, yeah. Schwarzenegger probably has something close. Like, those guys on that level, they just... If you're gonna get Will Smith to sit somewhere, or any A-lister, Tom Cruise to sit somewhere for fucking 12 hours a day while you shoot someone else, it better be a nice place.
Did you hear Tom Cruise wants to date Shakira? I read that.
I did not hear that.
I read that. I can't remember. They met somewhere at a race car thing.
Yeah, some race thing.
Or a horse racing, F1 maybe, yeah. And then they said that Tom Cruise wants Shakira to be his next lady. I seen it.
Yeah. He looks a little strange in that picture.
He's getting older.
He is getting older.
It is a strange look to see him.
Is it a wig?
It's got to be something. It doesn't look like it's not natural hair.
Unless
they're extensions or whatever. I mean, he's Tom Cruise.
Yeah. He's been looking a little strange, maybe since like the Top Gun premiere-ish.
Yeah.
His face is a little puffier. Could be Scientology.
He's getting probably, I'm going to assume Botox because his face is puffier.
I think that's right.
No.
Maybe he's out of adrenochrome.
What is adrenochrome?
He can always get more. Tell him, Troy. Where do you get it from?
I don't know.
I forget. Where do you get it from?
I think you get it online somewhere.
Actually. Is that a children's blood thing?
Troy, is it?
David can get more.
I'm sure he can get more somewhere.
It's possible. It could be. Could you get it there?
Could you zoom in on that picture? I want to see his face from like across the...
Shelly doesn't need hers anymore.
Let me see.
Where is she, by the way? Wouldn't that be great to meet bad. Tom Cruise and just ask him?
Hey, where's Shelley?
Where's Shelley, by
the way?
That'd
be funny if he went right there and she was actually just there hanging out. He just looks strange. Like, I don't know why. Well, I can't put my finger on exactly what it is that makes him look different than he...
Well, it's
he's puffy.
His face is way puffier.
He's puffy. He's got 60.
And his nose is bigger. Like,
yeah.
I'm not saying he's an alcoholic, but sometimes alcoholics get big puffy
noses.
His nose
is bigger. Like they also get red noses, though.
That's true. His nose is not red. But his nose is way puffier.
Has he always had a puffy nose?
No.
No. Shakira looks good, though.
Shakira.
She's like 48 or something.
Yeah.
Shakira's amazing.
She's incredible.
Shakira could use Scientology to make that tech stuff go away.
Can we see another picture of Tom Cruise, old picture of his nose? I never noticed that. Maybe his nose is puffier. Why would it be puffier? I don't understand.
Remember Wherever, Whenever?
I remember.
Oof, what a song.
Maybe he's always had that nose.
No, it's puffier now. It's way puffier now. His whole face is puffier.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. It's wider.
Maybe it's for a movie.
Yeah, maybe he's between movies and he can just eat a little bit, pig out.
Yeah.
You think he's pigging out a little after Top Gun?
I mean, he looks good in the Mission Impossible trailers.
Which one is this, 8?
7 or 8, yeah, and they filmed 2 back to back.
Can you imagine when Tom Cruise first started and became like a movie star, 60 was the age. Like, Wilford Brimley was 50.
I know.
You know what I mean? Like, by the time he was 60, it's like the world has no use for you anymore. But now, Tom Cruise at 60 in 2023, if you could have told him when you're 60, you'll be doing Top Gun movies that people love even more than the first. Yep. You'll be doing an 8th Mission Impossible where you're jumping off of buildings and you'll be dating Shakira. He'd be like, life is awesome.
I mean, he looks great for 60, but you got to have a couple of wrinkles or just use good face lotion. That's all.
I wonder if Tom Cruise, like, very quickly is going to turn into what George Hamilton. Like, I wonder if age is going to hit him in a hurry, and then it'll just be like that thing. Like, he'll just be plastic Tom Cruise, and that'll be fine.
I hope not.
I hope so.
I'm sure he has the money for the best stuff, but George Hamilton... Whatever he did, it seemed like subtle little tucks because his face wasn't bloated and weird looking.
There's nothing subtle about George Hamilton.
No, but he didn't have these fucking... He doesn't look like he's all puffy from Botox.
No, but he doesn't look like his... I mean, he looks like a wax sculpture from Madame Tussauds.
Because he's very tan and his teeth are very white.
And nothing
on his hair
is
very white. And he's very smooth. But Tom Cruise, to me, looks stranger than he does. Because it's a puffier look that he doesn't have.
Well, I think because Tom Cruise hasn't reached that form yet.
I don't know.
Tom Cruise is just starting.
Yeah, maybe he's just put on some weight.
Maybe.
In his nose?
The nose is very... I don't understand the nose.
I can't explain the nose.
Old men just get big noses.
I guess so,
and
yeah.
And big ears.
And I think it's also weird... It's a weird look on Tom Cruise. Because he's got old man features... But because he's got his hair looking young, his eyebrows are dyed, he's super tan. Like, he's keeping all the rest of himself looking younger than he is. But he's got old man face features. So he's got young man top of head, young man eyebrows, young man teeth, young man body, old man face, old man shape of face.
He's actually leaning in for the picture with her, which is so strange to see Tom Cruise wanting someone.
Oh,
take
yeah.
this picture, guys.
I get it, though. It's Shakira.
I know, but
she looks incredible.
Is Shakira perfect? I think
damn
so.
Damn near close.
I think so.
Yeah. Maybe he does like her. He's a lot taller than her.
Yeah.
How short is she?
She's 5'2", and he's 5'7".
Is she really 5'2"?
She's like 5'2". She's tiny.
Oh. Wow.
Oh, I've done a lot of research on Shakira.
I had no idea she was that short.
Oh, yeah. And she's single for now.
Oh, man.
Fuck, we fucked up, Troy.
We fucked up.
She's been single for a while, and now Tom Cruise is going in for the kill. We could have been in there.
I mean, she's just aging perfectly.
Yeah, she looks very nice, but 5'2 is a little.
46 years old.
5'2 make you feel like a man. This little Shakira next to you. Be great.
Maybe. I mean, don't get me wrong. She's very lovely.
The loveliest.
But.
Hips don't lie.
Bilingual.
Yeah.
Should yell at you in Spanish.
I'd love that.
Yeah. Wouldn't you? Like, you'd be in trouble, but you'd also be like...
I'd be horny.
You'd be trying to like hold it. She's like, what are you doing?
Come here, baby. Come here.
What are you doing? Bianchi, Bianchi. Jeff in Pennsylvania. What's up, Jeff?
Hey, Sam. Hey, I didn't know if you've heard of this show called Jury Duty. It's kind
of
like...
I've heard of the Pauly Shore vehicle, the film Jury Duty, starring Stanley Tucci, by the way.
That's right.
That is one of them. But the one I'm talking about just came out last month.
I've heard of it. I've heard people talking about it, but I don't really know anything about it, to tell you the truth. I haven't watched it.
Yeah. They have this one guy, and they have jury duty, and they get sequestered, but it's all... One guy's real, everyone else is actors. And then James Marsden's in it as himself. I think you'd enjoy it since you like the Joe Schmo.
The comedian?
Is it a reality show?
No, it's like a mockumentary thing. It's like where they have one real guy.
But the guy doesn't know?
He doesn't know, but everyone else is an actor. And then they sequester them all.
I'm down.
All together.
How do they get a real court for that, though?
I don't know. They faked it.
Maybe they faked the trial.
Craigslist or something, but they did it really well.
Oh, okay.
I'll have to take a look.
Because
I love that Joe Schmo show. What is going on here? You remember?
And also, I sent Travis some info on Edna Faust if he wants to check his DMs.
Check your DMs, Travis. People are DMing you.
Thank you.
Because Travis is also, thank you, Jeff. Travis has also lately been putting the brakes on the on-demand when it comes out.
Stop saying that.
Travis has been making it so that it comes out later than it should.
Why are you doing that, man?
On Demand is supposed to be up at by 2:30 p.m. and Travis delays.
I don't know why you delay. We get a lot of notes about it. And Travis's DMs are open. He wants to know about Edna Faust. And Travis says you don't have the guts to send him an unclipped penis picture.
Travis is playing.
I challenge them.
Travis is playing. Who's got the biggest in his DMs?
He'll rate your penis.
Yeah,
I will not.
Travis likes small dick humiliation. He'll humiliate your penis.
SPH.
Yeah.
It's not. None of that is true.
Your DMs are open though.
That's true. Yeah.
I watched that Joe Schmo show. I watched this Jury Duty show. I didn't realize it was like a real.
It's on Freevee.
It doesn't sound real.
Well, you're just judging that. You have no basis.
I don't. I'm always thinking of the jury system.
If I told you, if I explained the Joe Schmo show to you, you'd be like, no, it's fake. But it's not fake.
No, but the idea of a jury, unless they got him in some other way other than, because you get jury duty is a fucking notice the government sends you in the mail. So like, how do you fake that and then go to a real courtroom?
Well, I'll watch one episode and tell you.
Yeah, there's got to be a, unless they... They said you could volunteer for jury duty. Let's see.
You are now the jury in the matter of Hillgrove versus Morris.
When they say jury of your peers, I think that's accurate. I mean, how long does this normally take? Have you done this before?
James Marsden is on the jury?
I'm a recognizable public figure.
Oh.
Respectfully, I don't recognize you.
Okay.
Juror number 54.
I'm so happy to be here.
And they're in L.A.
I'm going to be upset if I don't
get on
the
jury. It's a real L.A.
court.
He thinks
it's
real.
Ready, guys? Here we go.
All right, so this is what happened.
Allegedly.
We got defecation. There's a lady named Jacquees. I'm in it.
Try to keep an eye on them.
I want to do the best job that I can.
Oh. What do people usually say when they're trying to get out of this?
I'm only going off the thing I've seen on Family Guy.
Wait, what was it?
We see Peter pretends to be racist to get out of jury duty.
Would you be able to be a good juror for this matter?
Sir.
I'm racist.
Sir, please have a seat.
I don't know why I said that.
Yeah. Eliminate that for the next time.
Totally, yeah. That's a stupid idea.
Actorish and written.
Well, yeah, the rest of them are
actors. No, I know, but just the whole thing feels...
Because the rest of them are actors.
No, I understand, but I'm saying it feels that way. It doesn't feel like... It just feels like it's all cute lines. No, good point. That little weird awkwardness.
Yeah. Ugh.
You want to finish it? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I hate
problem.
You're sequestered.
I Googled it. It's isolated.
Isolated.
Separated. Todd is a very interesting individual. He showed up wearing chair pants.
The difficulty is the lack of a bend.
Jesus Christ.
What are we looking at in here?
Hi, guys.
No!
Sorry. Jump scare.
This is the most unorthodox trial that I've presided over.
Oh, my God!
I try not to judge a book too much by its cover, but...
Call your next witness.
It's true that you were once arrested for masturbating in a movie theater.
Yes, that's true.
What was the movie?
Pacific Rim Uprising.
It's not sexy.
What?
I saw that. There was zero arousal for me.
Stinks.
This seems like a lot. Like,
yeah. I mean, it's one... It's a writer's room.
It seems
It'd
like a
lot. It'd be funny if you're awkward and you go...
Yeah. The only way it would work is if this guy's incredibly dumb, which is kind of how Joe Schmo worked.
What's going on?
The guy on Joe Schmo was incredibly dumb, but very, very charming and nice.
Yeah, that might have been, you know, I never saw it, but...
You didn't see it.
That's what I'm saying, I never saw it.
Yeah.
So no. That might have been different.
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah,
oh,
it was.
Way different. And this was before, like...
Before it was done a bunch of times. Yeah.
Yeah.
Assisted reality.
I'm not buying this at all.
And reality shows were actually, like, hot. Yeah. When Joe Schmo came out. Yeah.
And the idea of like the little Joe, you better sit, don't say that again. Okay. I just hate that fucking cute, awkward writer's room.
You hate writers.
No, writers are the...
You hate the strike. You're against the strike.
No, I hate writers. When I can see the writer's room on film, I hate it. Yeah. I love writers, but when they can see it on the film, I don't like it.
The writers want a minimum of 6 to 12 writers per show. That means every show is going to have a room for them.
Did they say 6 to 12 writers?
Yep.
Yeah, they want to keep writers' rooms.
Yeah.
Instead of...
They want each show to have a minimum of 6 freelance. To 12 writers and to have...
What if the budget doesn't allow for that?
And they want to have a minimum of how many weeks you'll be on staff, so you can't just let them go. Which is the... to make it like Travis just said, so that it's not like... Because otherwise they're just hiring a bunch of people freelance.
Sure.
With no guarantee of anything.
Oh, you work for a week, you work...
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I get it.
Yeah, I do too, but it also depends on the size of the project and what they need you for. What if the project doesn't need that many writers?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think...
Maybe it's a certain size budget or above what they want that.
Yeah, I think that the problem is that most of these projects that they're talking about are like big studio projects that definitely have the money for 6 writers.
Yeah.
If needed be.
Yeah, it's not like indie, like...
But what if you write something, or you and one other guy write something, and it's kind of done?
Well, I don't think it's like, hey, I sold this.
It's like for a series.
Yeah.
Oh, a series, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And then that way, if the series gets canceled after 4 weeks, you still get 10 weeks of pay, I guess. Mm-hmm. Like, they hire you to be like, okay, we can do this.
Yeah.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, I guess I'd have to. I don't know anything about it. I have not. This is all I've heard about it, is what you just said.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know anything about it.
Yeah.
Do the actors still get paid? If the series gets canceled, do they get paid? Maybe they do.
Well, this is a writers' union thing.
No. But I'm just in general saying.
Yeah. No, no. I mean, traditionally, the actors make a lot more money than the writers do. That's kind of what the.
Yeah.
One of the things the strike's about.
That they want to make what the actors make?
No, that they want to make a decent living, right? That there's a lot of money coming into the projects. Right. And, there's a lot of money coming into the projects.
Yeah.
And the writers are generally not put on a high priority in terms of who's getting paid.
Okay.
And royalties are different now with streaming.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, the studios will fuck you. They're like comedy clubs. Any chance they could fuck you, they'll fuck you.
Right.
But that's kind of what they're
want to protect
warning
against.
People about is that, like, you know, this writer's strike is kind of the first line. This will happen to actors next.
Yeah, and directors. Know. Yeah. I'm sure.
Every union is going to come up against this eventually. Yeah. It just happens that the writers are
first. Yep.
Yeah.
How about, the rumors are heavy, hot and heavy, that maybe Tucker Carlson's going to do his show on Twitter.
I know you guys think so. I don't see how that works.
What do you mean?
It's a one-hour show or whatever. It's very hard to get people to just...
He said he's going to bring a version of it to Twitter.
I think he'll do better off on Rumble or someplace where you can actually do long-form
content. Well, I also think you can't... I mean, there's nothing that would stop you from doing long-form content on Twitter.
Let me amend. Where people are used to watching long-form content.
All of these services are going to move to long form content because nobody can figure out how to make money in short form. That's why YouTube stopped pushing shorts.
Did they stop pushing shorts?
Yeah, Meta isn't paying creators for short form anymore. like for reels.
When did YouTube stop pushing shorts?
Well, they're not, they haven't completely stopped pushing, but I mean, even months ago, it was like the priority, and now it's just not.
Yeah.
Because you can't make money off shorts.
Right.
There's no room for ads.
Sure,
like,
sure.
They haven't, they're like,
how do you make money?
We can get eyeballs.
Right.
But we got to figure out how shorts can just push to long form where we can make real money. And, you know, Elon has publicly said that the company is worth half what he paid for it.
Maybe they're not, you know what? Maybe all these shorts, which are great, are not getting people to where they thought, hey, this will elbow them over here, but it doesn't.
No, I think that that's not the problem. The problem is that you can't make money directly off the shorts.
But weren't the shorts designed as a way to get you on the platform and as a way to get you to their larger channels? Weren't like, what, like, wasn't the point of YouTube pushing shorts to go, if Sam does these 10 million view shorts, it'll get people to your channel, which is how the money will be made? Because nobody's going to put ads on it. There's no one could think that you're going to make a lot of money from a 1 minute or 58 second
Instagram
video.
Instagram and TikTok and Facebook did.
YouTube had already the longer form thing where
they
made
were
money.
Losing people. They were losing people to TikTok and Instagram.
So maybe they figured that this.
They wanted to go like, okay, short form, everybody went short form, and then they pulled way back because they said there's no money in short form.
I think that they wanted to get people to their chat. I think they were hoping it would get people in the on the platform to their longer videos. Like they were hoping that that would somehow translate into people watching
it YouTube. It does, and they still are. But I'm saying that that's not, they were centering business around short form, and they're not anymore.
What plan did they ever have to make money on short form?
They literally monetized short form a few months ago.
How?
By trying to put ads.
Dropping ads in between the videos?
Yeah. Yeah, the same way Facebook tried to monetize it, the same way TikTok tried to monetize it, but TikTok is now upping to 10 minutes.
And Instagram is not.
Instagram's not paying.
I'm glad they're stopping that shit because it's like, it just, it's exhausting. Like, I look at it all the time, and you watch people's videos, and some of them are great, but none of it holds you. Like, it's like, it's 30, so who cares? Like, I'd rather see them do longer videos.
Yeah, ooh, yeah, I see, yeah. You got to do both. Because you're right. I mean, it does still draw people to the, because you're not wrong. Like, you still got to put out your bits. I think that the short-form content does draw people to, like, your special, for instance, or your channel or whatever.
Right.
That all still works.
Sure.
It's just, you can't make that the center point of your business. Like Facebook, Meta, I think, realized they were losing a ton of money.
Paying these people.
Paying these people and also just focusing on short form.
Yeah, I
going
mean.
Going like, yeah, no, the short form just has to, it has to be the commercial that brings you in, and TikTok the same way. And like some influencers can make money through like brand deals.
Right.
But the platform doesn't make that money.
Because they, I guess they put an ad in between five videos. You see an ad, people just swipe through the ad and don't click on it.
Yeah.
And then the advertisers are like, what the fuck are we doing?
Right.
A lot of people have looked at this and we've gotten no business.
Right.
It's stupid, so, yeah.
Unless you're like a podcast that has those mouth tape things.
This Bob Kelly thing. No, it's a real podcast. It's not a real podcast.
Yeah.
They're tricking you.
It's funny how we hate advertisers, all of us do, but they really do keep everything free. Like, as much as they're annoying, fucking commercial, like, that's why we're watching the Super Bowl for free or any of these other things for free. Like, I mean, I'm mad at myself, too, because I hate the commercials. I hate advertising. But that's the reason I'm getting to watch things for nothing.
People get real mad at advertisements, though, when they're paying.
Yes. Yeah, they do.
You know?
Yeah, 100%.
You're paying for a cable service. So it's not technically free.
Right. Cable originally, yeah, it's like pay TV. People get mad on Sirius when there's commercials.
Yeah.
I guess you are paying for cable, yeah, but
not enough to just like
not enough to justify. I mean, yeah, maybe there's an inconsistency there.
Yeah,
but I'm happy they're going away from only pushing those.
Yes, yes,
that's great.
Yes, they're pushing more long form. I absolutely think that Twitter's trying to figure out where they can get, because don't forget, Twitter's been trying to figure out video forever. Twitter bought Vine, you know, and it didn't work. Vine was the hottest thing.
It was 6, then 15 seconds, right? Didn't it go 6 seconds?
Yeah, or 15 seconds, people became, that's where like Logan Paul became a star, but it like, it didn't work. Everybody had to move on from it because it's like, it's good to get your attention right now. It's good to get eyeballs, but how do we make money? I think if Twitter wants to be as valuable as Elon wants it to be, they're going to have to do video.
Maybe.
There's no way you can stay text-based. And if they want to do video, like, it's not difficult to go from... There are already 10-minute videos on Twitter.
Yeah.
It's not difficult to make them an hour. There's no reason that somebody wouldn't
There's movies on Twitter.
Yeah, you could get movies. Like, they already do Twitter Spaces, which is like podcasting where people are tuning in for an hour of two people having a conversation on Twitter. Like, if Elon's got the money to throw it at Tucker, because it's going to cost a lot, I have no reason to believe that that's a bad idea, really, from either party. Because Twitter's also where the eyeballs are.
Yeah. I mean, all right, we'll see what he does. But I think he winds up...
I didn't take this at all as, hey, we signed a deal with Twitter. He's still under contract. Like, I don't think this means he's not going to Rumble.
I think Rumble is where he's going to wind up.
I just think this is like,
or
hey...
Or the Daily Wire.
I'm going to start posting content on Twitter. Because he can't sign a deal. He's got a deal.
He's going to just keep doing these Twitter videos
while
he's still on contract?
To keep himself relevant.
I'm going
to
stay relevant until I can sign a deal, maybe with Twitter... Maybe with Rumble.
I don't think Twitter's possible. The only reason is because it's a swipe. We're so used to swiping on it. It's a scrolling thing that you do.
Yeah, but if you subscribe to Tucker Carlson,
sure,
and then Twitter gets a cut of that.
Yeah,
watch videos on Twitter.
They do. I just don't think he'll wind up there. I think he winds up either on Rumble or Daily Wire or someplace that is more stable and known for that.
I think he also wants eyeballs. Like, yeah. Rumble and Daily Wire is already his audience. Like,
but,
there's
not. Look at all those eyeballs. Look at all the retweets. Look at
that's
the
what I
the
mean.
Impression.
Like, I think that first Good Evening video, when people were like, on Twitter, he had this video, and they started comparing it to all the other news sites, all the other everything. The fact that there's 82.5 million views on this video, like, that's not happening on Rumble.
No, but that can get you to Rumble. Like, he could still do this.
But, I mean, he just needs a fraction of that to be having the same amount of eyeballs that were on Fox News.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah.
All right, mark it today. I say he winds up, not on Twitter, but he'll use Twitter to get to any of those other platforms.
Whoever pays him more.
Whoever pays him more.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I don't know if Rumble can outbid Elon.
Right.
I don't know how much they have, but Twitter, they may be able to outbid Twitter if Twitter's worth half of what it was. They may not be able to... spend on one performer what he's going to want or what he could get from
Well, if they
Rumble.
Just have the one performer, they could.
Yeah.
Right?
Maybe he's not spending money on him. Maybe he gives him, like, a stock in Twitter.
Half the company or something.
Yeah.
We'll see. We'll probably know soon. We'll know within a few months, obviously.
He's trying to get out of the Fox deal, right?
Oh, yeah.
So he's just going to go talk shit until they cut him loose.
Yeah. Yeah, until he's a problem.
Yeah. Then again, if he can make $25 million, like if they won't cut him loose from the network, and he can make $25 million just doing these videos, keeping his name out there, he'll probably do this for free because it's like he's getting paid $25 million to make Twitter videos. And then
when his
contract's up, he goes where he wants to go.
Right. And he's used Twitter to build up like, hey, man, look at these numbers.
100%.
Right.
This is where I'm going next.
And also, if Twitter wants him, it's going to cost him a lot more now because there's proof of concept.
Yeah. Yep. So maybe this is just a smart way for him to stay relevant. It's not a network. It's social media.
Is there already 87 million on this video from yesterday?
I mean, it's 17.5 at 87 on the impressions. Yeah.
And look where the other one was. That was at 82. And that was a week ago.
That was a week ago. This one's already at 87. And you see what a difference it makes? The fact that that one is just a Twitter video on his phone. And the one from yesterday that's gotten more views already looks like a full production TV show.
Yeah.
And it's 3 minutes long and people are watching
it. Was the first one his phone and the second one's like real cameras?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, you want to watch a little of yesterday's
video? Yeah, I haven't seen this.
Hey, it's Tucker Carlson. You often hear people say the news is full of lies. But most of the time, that's not exactly right.
Exactly?
Much of what you see on
Hold on. Tucker, sometimes a take two is okay. It's not exactly.
Yeah, you could have stopped right there.
And said
you
exactly.
You wouldn't have had to just stop and,
That's where you need
Six
the two.
Seconds
in. That's where you need the side view camera just to do a quick cut.
Yes.
That's when they 100%. Do those two hammers so you can't see the cut. Exactly. Can we see that again? He says, exactly right.
Tucker Carlson. You often hear people say the news is full of lies, But most of the time, that's not exactly right.
Exactly.
Much of what you see on television or read the New York Times is in fact true in the literal sense. It could pass one of the media's own fact checks. Lawyers would be willing to sign off on it. In fact, they may have. But that doesn't make it true. It's not true. At the most basic level, the news you consume is a lie of the stealthiest and most insidious kind. Facts have been withheld on purpose, along with proportion and perspective. You are being manipulated. How does that work? Let's see. If I tell you that a man has been unjustly arrested for armed robbery, that is not, strictly speaking, a lie. He may have been framed. At this point, there's been no trial, so no one can really say. But if I don't mention the fact that the same man has been arrested for the same crime six times before, am I really informing you? No, I'm not. I'm misleading you. And that's what the news media are doing in every story that matters, every day of the week, every week of the year.
Who can save us? Who can save us? Who can stop this?
Tucker doesn't do that, right?
That is the beautiful part of it. It's like everyone...
he literally does the same thing.
But it's part of that job.
Oh, yeah.
Like those guys, all of them do that because it has to fit the narrative of the side, so they all withhold.
They're lying to you.
All of them.
Even the fact that instead of saying newspapers, he said the New York Times. Like, that is clearly...
He's also probably got to be extremely careful what he says about Fox.
Oh, yeah.
He has to be, like, really careful. And he's a... Look, this guy, whether you love him or hate him, he's a great talker. He's very good at succinctly putting a point out there. Like, he's excellent at getting a point across, and he's not stupid.
He's not
stupid. He is not stupid. He's probably not going to badmouth Fox.
I wonder if he'll...
Yet.
He will.
Oh, yeah.
But you know what? Maybe he signed something where he's not... Who knows? They may have those non-disparagement clauses. Who knows?
I wonder if he'll sign some kind of deal to just be everywhere and have everybody pay him.
You mean with exclusive on one?
Yeah. So it's like, yeah, I'll post this on Twitter if you pay me. I'll post this on Rumble if you
pay me. Yeah, maybe.
Like, it's valuable to every platform.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And instead of getting $100 million, you get $8 million from this guy, $12 million from that guy. Yep.
And he's getting paid by each platform.
That's right.
Because it's valuable.
Yeah, maybe he does that.
Maybe.
A little more.
Every week of the year. What's it like to work in a system like that? After more than 30 years in the middle of it, we could tell you stories. The best you can hope for in the news business at this point is the freedom to tell the fullest truth that you can. But there are always limits. And you know that if you bump up against those
limits... I know what he's saying. Okay, I just heard a whistle. I just heard the dog whistle. You know what he was saying? I tried to tell you the truth before, but even where I was before...
I wanted to.
Even though that was the most truth, it wasn't the full truth.
Yeah.
I heard it. I heard the whistle.
But it's not because of me. It's because of them.
Because of them.
They stopped it. Sure.
I won't say who it was.
Yep. Can't.
Not yet.
Wink,
I got 25 mil on the table.
Yeah. He's not dumb.
Did you feel that nudge, Troy?
Oh, yeah. Hope for in the news business at this point is the freedom to tell the fullest truth that you can. But there are always limits. And you know that if you bump up against those limits often enough, you will be fired for it. That's not a guess.
Oh.
It's guaranteed.
Okay.
Oh, so here's what happened. Is he talking about Don Lemon?
He's saying that Don Lemon
right.
would tell the truth, but was restricted by the company
right.
and pushed up against it with truth one too many times, and they got rid of him.
Yep. That's it. You're right.
He's it's a big guaranteed. Don Lemon defender.
He loves Don Lemon.
Every person who works in English language media understands that.
Oh, boy.
The rule of what you can't say defines everything. It's filthy, really, and it's utterly corrupting. You can't have a free society if people aren't allowed to say what they think is true. Speech is the fundamental prerequisite for democracy. That's why it's enshrined in the first of our constitutional amendments.
Best one.
Amazingly, as of tonight, there aren't many platforms left that allow free speech.
I can't wait to find out which one. I can't wait. Which is the one? Which is the one?
As the big one remaining in the world, the only one is Twitter, where we are now.
Uh-huh.
Twitter has long served as the place where our national conversation incubates and develops. Twitter is not a partisan site. Everybody's allowed
Come
here.
Come on, dude.
And we think that's a good thing.
Could you hit pause for a second? You're meaning to tell me you don't think he's discussed having a deal with Elon?
I'm sure he's disgusted.
Maybe he just did a commercial for Twitter.
Yeah, of course. But I don't think this is like, hey, I signed with Twitter because
he can't sign.
Yeah.
Yep. But is he allowed to get paid to do ads? Meaning, do you think? I wonder if he's getting paid just for this video. Is he allowed to do to get paid to do an ad?
Well, there's.
Bro, this is like when Aaron Rodgers was like, "No, I can't leave this team, but I don't like it here."
Yeah, I don't disagree.
Yeah.
I'm just glad that Twitter's not a partisan site. Everybody is allowed here.
Yeah, everybody is allowed on Twitter. Yeah.
It does funny, though. Whoever's in charge of Twitter really dictates who gets in trouble for what.
It was a partisan site last year?
Yeah, two years ago, it was a very partisan site.
Yeah.
But now it's not.
Now it's not. No.
That's all good.
I just think that this... I'm glad that they're doing moves like this that won't further politicize it.
Yeah.
And yet, for the most part, the news that you see analyzed on Twitter comes from media organizations that are themselves thinly disguised propaganda outlets. You see it on cable news. You talk about it on Twitter. The result may feel like a debate, but actually, the gatekeepers are still in charge. We think that's a bad system. We know exactly how it works, and we're sick of it.
Dude.
Starting soon, we'll be bringing a new version of the show we've been doing for the last 6.5 years to Twitter. We'll be bringing some other things, too, which we'll tell you about.
Come on.
But for now, we're just grateful to be here. Free speech is the main right that you have. Without it, you have no others. See you soon.
Elon is putting the future of Twitter on this guy, and it's not a bad bet.
Yeah.
Whether you agree with him or not.
He's got no other bets.
Elon?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not...
And this one kind of fell in his lap.
Yeah. It's not a bad
it
move.
It did.
I think Elon is going to end up paying Tucker a lot of money, and it's...
And he's almost unfireable because Elon is in charge. What could he possibly do to get in trouble? I mean, there's no FCC, no nothing. Yeah,
I agree.
All it takes is one disruptor.
They could ban the app, though, right?
I mean, that would be such. They would.
That would take a lot.
That would take a lot to ban the
Apple App Store banning the app. That would
banning the Twitter app. I mean, that would be a disaster for them.
Yeah,
there's no reason for it. Too many.
They've done it to other apps, haven't they?
They have to be so extreme, though.
Yeah.
Well, if he's going to go on and say some crazy shit on Twitter,
they didn't ban.
You think it'll get crazy?
Oh, I can't wait. I can't wait to hear what he says.
They didn't ban it, and all these other people, these fucking terrorist organizations have Twitter accounts, all these
here's why they won't ban it.
Racists have it. There's no way they're banning it because of Tucker.
Here's why they won't ban it. Because Tucker will do 1 hour free and a second hour if you're subscribed to Twitter Blue. People will use their iPhones to subscribe to Twitter Blue, and they'll want that 30%.
That's exactly it, because greedy Apple takes 30%.
Yeah. Apple will want that 30% of the Tucker checks.
How long is his show now?
On Fox, it was, an hour with commercials.
Oh, an hour?
No, it was 8 to 9 with commercials, so 42 minutes.
So how long will he do? I don't see him doing a 2-hour show a day. Will he do?
I could see it. I mean, the internet's different, and he knows the internet.
Yeah.
Guests, obviously.
Yeah.
So he's not. But, yeah, I mean, I could see him putting in some work. Don't forget, he would also do a daily show for Fox Nation.
In the morning.
Wally would also be doing a daily show on Fox News, so he was putting in hours. He wants to continue to build that base, that loyal base.
Yeah.
And it's tough to build that loyal base if you're not putting in significant time.
We'll see how long he does. If he does it 2 hours, I don't think he does 2 hours, but
2 hours is a lot.
It's a lot of content. And plus a free hour, a lot of people will be done after a free hour. Like, a lot of people are not going to want to go into a second hour on Twitter. They may give them a free 10 minutes, and then an hour after that you
or
have to pay for.
30.
Well, 30 and 30. But I think the way to rope people in is to give them 10 minutes, because that's like enough time. Like, you're watching this, it's very compelling. And they go, if you want to see today's show, you subscribe, you get the whole show.
There are a lot of people It's the Crowder model. Like, Crowder does an hour.
Yep.
And then he goes on and keeps going on his site. But it's not necessarily even about making sure that you watch every minute of the show. It's about, like, hey, this is about protecting our freedoms.
Yep.
If you sign up to this service, we're protecting our freedoms. You sign up to the service. See, and then Elon's like, hey, like, immediate quote tweet. On this platform, unlike the one-way street of broadcast, people are able to interact, critique, and refute whatever is said. And of course, anything misleading will get @community notes. I also want to be clear that we have not signed a deal of any kind whatsoever. It's a little lawyer note.
That's for Fox.
Yep. Yeah. Tucker is subject to the same rules and rewards of all content creators.
Rules and rewards. Okay. Yeah.
Rewards mean subscriptions and advertising revenue share coming soon, which is a function of how many people subscribe and the advertising views associated with the content. I hope that many others, particularly from the left, also choose to be content creators on this platform.
Okay. So he's making a real push for it.
Yeah. And that's...
Will he bring Don Lemon over? Like, does he say both of these fired network guys?
I don't think it's necessary. I mean, Don, first of all, Don doesn't have the audience that Tucker has.
No, but I mean, like...
And he doesn't have to do both.
For proof that... But he wants to for the money. Like, if it becomes known as a right-wing thing, you're losing... It's just from finance. You're losing half your audience. But if he brings over or attempts to bring over Don Lemon, even though Tucker's much bigger, people go, wow, that's fair.
I don't think people will say that. Reasonable people would say that. You would say that. I would say that. People aren't that reasonable.
No, but he literally went out of his way to say, I hope people on the left as well.
He said that.
And he said that for a reason, because he doesn't want just conservatives, because that's half the money.
Yeah.
It's stupid. He'll bring somebody big. And if he brings over or tries to bring over a guy like Don Lemon, again, even though Tucker's bigger, he's making a statement.
It would be a good
thing
to do. Fox
fired this guy. CNN fired this guy. Both of these guys have a free voice here. And don't think Don Lemon wouldn't do it, because, again, he would be...
What else he doing?
More people would see him here.
And more
on CNN, he was bombing in the morning.
Yeah. And I'm sure that they would, even if they didn't have anything in writing, they would push him forward to make sure that the rev came in.
Yeah.
You know?
Just because, again, that gets other people on his side to want to do the same thing.
How about that timing on Chris Cuomo? Chris Cuomo had gotten fired now. He could have been the guy.
That's right.
Yeah. He got fired right before. Timing is a motherfucker.
But he's got a gig, though, Chris. I don't know what he's making it. Is it News? Not Newsmax, is it?
You don't even know what the network... I don't know, what the network's called.
Where they're trying to do balanced news. But he might be making the same money.
News Nation?
News Nation, there you go.
Balanced news.
Yeah, that's kind of their calling card.
But it's not it's just not the way things work anymore. It's nice. It's a nice thought.
I liked his show, and I really didn't watch it on CNN, but I was in LA and I saw some of it, and I liked the way he was. You could still see he's liberal, but I was like, I liked how he was addressing. Demands new time slot. His ratings are tanking. How many people a night's he
that
doing?
That was from October, though.
Oh,
I mean, who's even watching the News Nation?
I mean, I was on it once with Dan Abrams, and I didn't.
Did you get any feedback on it?
I have to pee.
Let's take a break.
Tonight, 7 p.m., Fat Black Pussycat. And if you want to meet the trucker and watch me be abducted and murdered, May 19th, I will be in Bethlehem, PA. The 20th, of course, is Montclair. And then I got July 14, 15 at Rogan's Club in Austin. Fucking Texas in July. I am a truly stupid asshole.
Yeah, but you know what?
Dunce.
Come on, it's the comedy mothership. It's hot right now.
No, I know. I want to shoot something too, either there or somewhere.
Hey, like, man, Texas is the place to do it.
Des Bishop was shooting last night in the, and I'm like, it's been too long since I've shot something. I don't care if nobody watches it on YouTube. I just want to get the material out.
People will watch it.
I mean, I have no faith in that because everyone's doing it. I don't think anybody cares anymore.
Put it on Twitter.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
Boom. We'll be right back. The Great Arbiter of Truth.
Jim and Sam will be back. Jim and Sam will be back. Jim and Sam will be back. Jim and Sam will be back after this. Jim and Sam are back now. Jim and Sam are back now.
Welcome back, Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Maybe it's just the era of this song, but it's interesting. As we were just like in the last break talking about new media and the idea that, like, you know, shows and personalities and stuff are going to Twitter, a big legacy media chunk got taken out yesterday. The end of MTV News.
Yeah, MTV started in, what was it, 81? MTV, yeah. 81, and then 87, I think the news started. Mm. It never, I remember it being so big, and I remember like learning so, you know, there was so much information you got about, but after a while, it just kind of, in my, at least my sight line, went away.
Oh, yeah, no, it was huge the whole time, because before there was social media, you'd just be sitting there watching MTV, and then all of a sudden during a commercial break, those typewriter things would come on, and an MTV news brief would come on.
Before TMZ had that way. Yes. They knew how to get your attention.
And Kurt Loder or John Norris or Tabitha Sorin or what's his name, Chris Connolly?
Was Loder the first?
He was.
We always hated Kurt Loder because he was so boring.
Well, he was like
a stiff Rolling Stone idiot.
You thought he was a big idiot.
You know how I felt about that magazine.
Yeah,
that to me was the physical form of that shit magazine.
That's a good call. Oh yeah, Serena Altschul.
Love Serena Altschul.
She was really
smoking
hot. I remember Soo Chin Park. That was like towards the end, probably, of my era.
Sway.
What up, world? That's where it came from. Yeah. What up, world? This is Sway with MTV News. Sway gave us some scoops too.
Tabitha Sorin
was the shit. Kennedy
was dope.
Kennedy
did MTV News.
Yeah, she started as a VJ, but went into.
And then she did Alt Nation, or what was the alternative? Not 120 minutes. There was like a nightly alternative show that she did.
That's right. But yeah, like you'd just be sitting there watching MTV, and that's when you get your scoops. Like if an artist was dead or something was breaking or whatever. Tabitha Sorin or Allison Stewart would come on and tell you.
Ananda Lewis. What's up?
What's up, Ananda Lewis? I always associate Ananda Lewis more with like spring break, though. When they go to the beach house.
Yeah. Adam Curry was cool.
He was one of the original VJs.
Hell yeah.
And the original podcast guy. Right?
Yeah.
Adam Curry like started podcasts.
Oh, did he?
Like he was the first podcast. He kind of did a lot to launch the technology, yeah.
A lot of people hated John Norris. I like John Norris.
John Norris is kind of a tool.
Is Adam Curry, did he make a lot of money from that or no? From the podcasting thing, did he get any kind of...
I think he made some money, but not like today's standard money. John Norris was a tool, dude.
Nah, he was all right.
Nah.
Like if...
He looked like the shitty version of Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers, like the Wish version of Flea.
Oh, the Peps.
From the Peps.
If Kurt Loder wasn't around and John Norris was filling in, you'd be like, all right, whatever.
No, I'd be like, where's Tabitha?
I go, where's Tabitha or Serena Altschul?
Yeah. I wasn't like, oh, good, John's here to give me the news.
Because Serena Altschul was hot, but also had a sternness to her.
Ooh. Yeah.
You know, not like that.
By the way, there's a woman in my gym who looks like either Howard or Joey Ramone. It's no woman. No woman is happy to be told that.
No.
I shouldn't have. I told her.
No.
I know, but I screamed it across the gym.
See, I guess yesterday Paramount cut like 25% of their staff or something, and the entire MTV News division was part of it. I don't know. I mean, I guess they were online, but I don't know what kind of a cultural force MTV News was.
No one's talking because no one, you just get it. Again, Twitter is just so immediate and it's just there.
Yeah.
So many other ways.
That's why you have to adapt. That's why.
I guess so, right?
Elon's adapting.
Yeah.
You could have told me MTV News shut down 15 years ago.
I kind of didn't know it either. Isn't Vice declaring bankruptcy?
Yeah. Vice is declaring bankruptcy.
The amount of money they were almost sold for.
And they blew it, man. They were hot.
They were hot. And they were early on the video content. Remember when Vice would put out those YouTube documentaries?
That's right. And they were good.
They were great.
They were really good. I think they were a little disorganized. When you dealt with Vice, and I dealt with them, they were disorganized. There was a lot.
Oh, yeah, you did that pilot for them.
Yeah. And we did four episodes. And behind the scenes, it was very hard to get anything done because everything bottlenecked. Because they didn't like to delegate certain things. It might have been different after I was there. But we had a hard time getting like a producer on it or just... Like I interviewed Tyson and Dana and it went over an hour. And like the whole show was supposed to be 30 minutes. And I'm like, nobody was indicating to me that it was going like...
But don't you wish...
Like, you know, little stuff like that.
Do you still have those shows?
They're somewhere. Yeah, I don't...
Do you have the rights to it or do they retain the rights?
I imagine they did, but they're out there.
It's like you on a TV set for an hour with Mike Tyson or Dana White. Like, that'd be so good online now.
Oh, maybe, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, if you could just put a budget together to put that, like, 70s-style talk show back up, you could just do that on the internet.
Yeah, you could. And I was really... It wasn't exactly the way I wanted to do it. I wanted it to be very Dick Cavett-ish.
Mm-hmm.
But we were... I had to fight to not have a sign with my name in lights. Like, old, like, dressing room lights.
You didn't want that?
No. Norton and dressing room lights?
Because it'd be too cheesy.
Yeah, like Gervais did it. It was very funny when he put Ricky.
But his was a different vibe.
It was done to be, to make fun of it.
Dick Cavett didn't have Cavett and big neon letters behind.
Of course not. No. But I mean, I'm just...
No, I get what you're saying.
You know, they... I don't know what happened behind the scenes with why they didn't get the money, but they were very close to selling, I think, for a lot.
The company, you mean?
Yeah.
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 Yeah. So, yeah. Rest in peace to MTV News Division.
Yep.
Yeah.
And also, I think it'd be BuzzFeed, too.
BuzzFeed, yep. BuzzFeed News is done. Which, again, I...
Yeah.
Sucks
but
for everybody
not the
that
whole
worked.
Company?
No, I think it's just the news part. I think just BuzzFeed News. BuzzFeed will be leaning into AI and creators after shutting the news division. Yeah, so that means they're probably going to have a couple people to hopefully make videos for them that catch some traction, and then AI will write their articles or something.
Or maybe just, you know.
Just a streamline.
Repurpose others.
I mean, this isn't that. I feel like all these media companies, it's kind of turning into what the dot-com bubble did, where everybody, it was just like, you know, everybody's launching a content company.
Yeah.
Everybody's bloated. Everybody's overstaffed. Nobody needs all this stuff. You can do this with three people in your basement, but instead, you got all this stuff going on, and reality is starting to knock people in the face with a sledgehammer, especially if they're not evolving.
Yeah.
Like, things are moving real fast.
They are. They are.
I mean, I just, the rumor is that my pal, I think you like him. I don't know if you know him. Pat McAfee is...
I've never met Pat.
You guys would get along.
Yeah, we've had him on, right? Like on, has he never been on our show?
I don't know, maybe.
Well, I guess you're not that good of friends with him, but
I've had him on my show.
Exactly. He doesn't like me.
Yeah, that's what it is.
No, I don't know if we've ever, for some reason, I know I've talked to him.
Maybe he has been on the show. Maybe he's called in or something.
He has, yeah.
But yeah, there are rumors that he's going to pop over to ESPN now and maybe bring his whole operation with him.
He's leaving a $120 million FanDuel deal?
There's a lot of rumors that he's leaving. Now, I don't know, like, because it's just an endorsement deal. Like, the thing that's interesting is FanDuel, I think, is trying to launch a content network, a TV network, whatever you want to call it, but they don't have the infrastructure built for it yet. And they certainly don't have the infrastructure built for someone like Pat.
Right.
So he's been on YouTube this whole time, just doing his own show that's paid for by FanDuel. But yeah, the rumor is that he may be leaving FanDuel, or who knows, maybe FanDuel stays on as a sponsor.
Sure.
As he goes to ESPN. But that's the heavy rumor.
Hate ESPN.
Why do you hate ESPN?
They never stick up for their talent when they like get in trouble. Like,
it's bad
never.
News for Pat.
No, but I'm sure with him, the size of his
operation.
Business. Yeah, I'm sure he would have that in place where...
He's pretty smart business
He's a smart guy.
Guy,
yeah.
Yeah.
But I hate them because they just never stick up for people who get in trouble.
Pat does all his own deals too.
Yeah, he's smart, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, I'm sure there are exit clauses, and you know,
he negotiates everything himself. Mm-hmm. I mean, with a lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's great. Agents don't get it done.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I mean, who knows? I mean, that's a big get for ESPN. That's good news for them.
I guess so. Yeah. Yeah.
Because I mean, Pat's the biggest independent sports guy there is.
I think so, yeah.
He had the number of people that he had on that Aaron Rodgers show was insane. Millions of people watching Aaron Rodgers on his show when he was first announcing. But yeah, I mean, he does like hundreds and hundreds of thousands every day just on YouTube.
And he does it live.
Live. He does like 2 or 3 hours live every day. It's like it's a sports show.
It's a real
show.
Gig, yeah.
It's a sports show. But he does it himself.
Yeah, he's just a personality.
He's great. I can't wait to see what he does.
Yeah.
And if this is all, this is all where it's going, you know?
I mean, he posted a photo with Bob Iger like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah. Yeah, he did. And you wouldn't do that unless you were close.
I was jealous of that photo.
Because you like Bob Iger?
I want a photo of Bob Iger.
Yeah. I don't think that his conversations with you would be as mutually beneficial as they were with Pat.
No. No, but you asking stupid mini questions.
You think Travis would be asking too many questions about Minnie Mouse?
Yeah, or asking about, hey, when are they going to bring back the fucking Crispy Critters to the Bumblefuck Jamboree treat?
Everybody's got their own questions.
Bob would be like, how did you get this meeting?
Yeah. No, but I mean, you guys used to have carrot cake at the Bumblefuck Jamboree. Now you don't. Where's the carrot cake? Yep.
The crunchy carrot cake was the best.
It's a good photo.
Yeah. Bob Iger just looks like a guy with a lot of money.
Everything about him.
The smile. Sure, I'll pose. It's cute.
He looks like he's in charge. That's why the second he came back.
Everything on him looks expensive. It looks like an expensive haircut, expensive teeth, an expensive face. He goes to an expensive gym. He has an expensive shirt on, an expensive sweater.
Tan.
Expensive tan.
And Pat McAfee, like, he just looks comfortable, like, oh, yeah, sure, I'll stop, Pat. Go ahead, take the picture. It's cute. He doesn't mind.
Yeah.
He looks like a guy in charge.
Yeah. Yeah, he does.
He's the man.
Yep. Pat's just Pat wherever he goes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he is. T-shirt. No,
tank top.
Tank top. Good for him.
He almost quit at WrestleMania, his first WrestleMania, because they told him to put pants on. He got yelled at. It's like,
what, did he wear shorts?
Yeah, he had like a tuxedo jacket and shirt and like, he made tuxedo shorts. And I guess he got scolded. He was like, I told you to dress professionally. Like, you got to have pants on, Bob. Like, and Pat was like, uh-uh. Like, I'm not here to get yelled at or be talked to like this or be told to wear pants. And so he's getting ready to pack up. He's like, I'm not doing the show. I'm going to quit. And they were like, no. You can wear the shorts.
Does he still wear the shorts?
100%. Look, that's him at WrestleMania. He wore the shorts.
Ah. Like, it literally looks like a skirt. It looks like a skirt.
But you know what? I mean, he's famous for his legs.
Does he have good gams?
The best. Have you seen the way this guy kicks?
Dude, is that a fucking way to get famous?
Well, I don't know if you... It's not only has great legs, but he does really good things with them.
All right, I'm just saying. That I mean, the Norton legs are not nearly as powerful as McAfee legs, but I guarantee you that they have the same dreamy sightliness.
I would bet that he'd be impressed with you.
Yeah, he'd probably. How do you get your calves like that?
Yeah,
tell him that's just it's the Norton trade secret. It's from holding in our shits.
Is that what it is? Just clenching.
It's from kneeling and holding in your shits and pretending girls like you.
Come on, look at those legs. Those are not designed to be covered up.
Yeah, no, those are kick a ball fucking 80-yard legs.
Yeah, I mean, and before that, he was playing soccer. All right. Like all he does is use those legs.
Yep.
I don't ever wear shorts.
Why?
Exact same reason Pat always does wear shorts.
Do you have little spindly legs?
I do. They're little toothpicks shooting out of my pelvis.
Take your pants off.
Show them off.
Let's see your legs.
Y'all wish.
Yeah, come on.
Drop trowel.
Let's have a bulge competition.
I'm down. This took a turn. Troy, you didn't bat an eye.
We're going to show off our bulges?
Or did you guys say something about a bulge competition? Yeah. So, the media landscape always changing.
Yep.
It's always exciting. Always stuff happening. Meanwhile, RFK is doubling down everywhere he goes.
At the CIA?
RFK Jr.?
Yep.
He's running for president.
Yep.
And everywhere he goes, he's telling people the CIA either were responsible or for the murder of JFK.
Oh, for JFK, yeah.
I think JFK was the one. It was my father's first instinct that the agency killed his brother.
Oh.
Huh.
Let's see. Can we see him saying it?
So he's saying that...
He's running as a Democrat, too, which is amazing.
He is running as a Democrat.
The hot seat time.
Hot seat time, baby. Hannity hot seat.
Unexpected challenge from inside his own party.
Murder of your uncle. What would it
look?
Do you believe they murdered or were involved in the murder of your uncle? What have you come to personally?
The CIA, yes, they were definitely involved in the murder and the, you know, and the 6-year cover up. They're still not releasing the, you know, the papers that legally they have to release. But I don't think there's any doubt if you look at this.
Oh, wow.
huge, you know, monumental mountain of evidence and confessions. And, you know, so many people have confessed to their involvement.
Robert Kennedy Jr. joins us now. Great to have you back, sir. How are you?
What an intro.
How are you, Sean? Good to be back.
Okay, you said the evidence is overwhelming and beyond any reasonable doubt that the CIA was involved in the killing of your uncle, a U.S. president. What is the evidence?
Well, you know, there's millions of pages of documents, of CIA documents, of transcripts, of recorded conversations from the Cuban embassy in Mexico City. From to summarize the evidence, there are, as I said in that podcast, there are confessions of people who were directly involved in the plot.
Could you pause for just a sec? Do you remember when he was going to, wasn't he the one that was going to tell you?
He was talking to us during the break. What happened is
he was telling you, so this was off mic, so he probably tell you even
more. This was off mic. RFK was telling this to Open Ant and myself.
Wow.
And luckily, we were interrupted by 2 minutes.
Who did that?
Eric.
And then did he just keep...
No, he didn't. Oh. No. You ever see two dogs fucking when cold water gets splashed on them?
That Eric
picture one dog fucking another dog about to tell him about the Kennedy assassination. And then Eric walking in with a bucket of cold water. It was 1 minute, I think. 1 minute! Oh. I just came.
Play some goddamn production. We're about to find out about the Kennedy assassination.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, guys. Radio. Was paying attention.
His voice is really, I
ooh,
wish, RFK, I wish they could fix that, because it makes him so hard to listen to.
He can't be president.
No.
No.
State of the Union?
No.
That would take forever.
And it is, in a way, shallow of us, but it's hard to hear the information. It's like, it's too...
Sounds like he's gargling with gravel.
Is there nothing they can do for that?
I'll tell you what.
God damn it. Because he has a lot of interesting things to say.
He said all this JFK stuff pretty clearly. He did not leave any wiggle room in that.
Yeah.
He said,
but he's not giving it. I want specific. I mean, again, he knows all way more than I do. But I want to hear
millions of pages.
I know, but I want to hear so-and-so said this on this day. Or, you know, I guess it is hard to summarize.
Maybe he gets into it.
Okay, let's
see.
Well,
we're having a tough time here.
Well, what happened?
They're just playing commercials after commercials on here.
I would like my... I suck my... I'm in your mouth.
Like Fox News video player is not that good.
It's not the best. No.
Okay.
You know what was easier?
What's that?
Playing that video off Twitter.
Yeah, it was easier.
You know why?
Huh?
Truth.
This is going to be a. I don't know where we are here.
Yeah.
You got this, Troy.
You got it, Troy. Play and make it bigger.
You joins us now. Great to have you back, sir.
We already heard this.
Okay.
Yeah, zip in there.
To summarize the evidence,
we already heard
there
this.
Are, as I said, involved in the plot, who were involved in the planning of the plot, who were peripheral to the plot. There's a 60-year cover-up.
Oh.
The Warren Commission was run by Alan Dulles, who was the head of the CIA, who my uncle fired, and then insinuated himself onto the Warren Commission and essentially ran the Warren Commission and kept this evidence from the Warren Commissioners. Either way, when Congress, 10 years later, investigated the crime with much more evidence than the Warren Commission had at its disposal, Congress found that, it was a plot. It was a conspiracy. There were multiple people involved. And most of the people in that investigation believe that it was the CIA that was behind it.
Is he talking about the coupon? I don't know. And again, there was a second one where they said that due to an acoustic evidence, there was a second shooter.
What do guitars have to do with it?
Because there was a lot of music being played.
Oh, okay.
And they were playing songs like Duck. We bombed together.
We did.
We bombed together.
We came together and it made one big explosion.
Yeah. We did together. We can both contributed a half of a funny thought.
Yes, we did.
And it became a zero funny thought.
Neither one of us got there.
No, but there was acoustic evidence that they said was a gunshot recorded, which by nature made it a conspiracy.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's other later things that were done where they said that the thing that they had attributed to that fourth shot came from a cop's microphone, police microphone a mile away. I don't know if that's true or not, but that's just, this is what he's talking about.
Mm.
Want more of
this? Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah.
The magic bullet never made any sense to me. I'll tell you that.
That was RFK going like, "You basic bitch."
Let's talk about that magic bullet. We all know that, you basic bitch. No bullets are made of magic, okay? There's no way that bullet could have done what it did to do a tap dance too.
RFK's on a roll.
I know.
And he's like, magic bullet. And you're like, oh, goddamn.
Yeah, that is like it's like watching like Carlin discuss a bit and someone going, dude, how fucking funny are farts?
RFK's over here going like, we have millions of pages that back this up. And Hannity's like, I saw the trailer for that movie. Yeah. Look fucked up.
Makes no goddamn sense, the magic bullet.
Yeah. Thanks, Sean.
And when I was a little boy, Sean, I was in the White House. My uncle was, you know, laying at rest in the East Room, being waked. And I was standing in the main foyer of the White House with my aunt Jackie Kennedy and my father and my mother. And President Johnson came in and told us that Lee Harvey Oswald had just been killed by Jack Ruby. And I said to my mom at that point, I turned to her and I said, why did he kill him? Did he love our family? Well, you know, that's a lingering question. What was Jack Ruby doing there? My father, when he investigated Jack Ruby, he found out that Jack Ruby had been deeply involved with Carlos Marcello's mob, with Sam Giancana, and all the people who were all of those mob leaders, Santos Traficante, who were the Havana casino owners who had been recruited by the CIA in the Castro murder plot. So they were all working together in cahoots with the CIA. By the way, the day that my uncle was killed, I was picked up at Sidwell Friends School and brought home. The first phone call that my father made after J. Edgar Hoover told him that his brother had been shot was to the CIA desk officer in Langley, who was only a mile from our house.
Should pause for a second. And
he's on a roll now, though. He's easy to understand. Yeah,
he's on a good roll. I love it. What I don't love is the fact that they flash breaking news on his chyron.
Oh, I didn't even see that. Yeah,
and it's like, what are you talking about? Breaking news? Yeah, we're just talking about JFK.
Yeah, that's a news thing. Yeah,
why are you putting breaking news?
Yeah, that's unnecessary.
Well, I mean, he's on national television saying the CIA killed his uncle.
Yep.
I guess that is kind of big news.
I guess.
Is it breaking though, or did we already know?
I mean, some of us.
And he's saying it as a presidential candidate. He's saying it as a presidential candidate.
Yes. Yeah. But Troy, really, is it breaking? Or did we know? You know what I'm saying?
I mean, some people have known for a long time, so we were just figuring it out. Yeah. I'll tell you, listening to him gives me anxiety.
It gives you anxiety.
Yeah.
But it's a little easier now, like when he's on a roll. I just wish for his sake they could fix that, because he's obviously a very smart guy.
Yeah, very smart.
And he's a great talker.
Mm-hmm. All right, you want to keep going?
Yeah. Right. For a minute.
And my father said to him, did your people do this? His next call was to Harry Ruiz, who was one of the Cuban Bay of Pigs leaders who had remained very, very close to our family and to my father. My father asked him the same question. Then my father called John McComb, who was the head of the CIA, and asked him to come to the house. McComb came over, and when I came home from Sidwell Friends School, my father was walking in the yard with John McComb, and my father was posing the same question to him. Was it our people who did this to my brother? So it was my father's first instinct that the agency had killed his brother.
We could spend a whole show on it.
Probably should.
Yeah. I would imagine that there's nothing more critical than that.
Yeah, I mean, that's a very it's a very worthwhile topic.
I think so. We probably should. Yeah. Yeah. Like, you should just run into the Laura Ingraham Hour talking about this.
Yeah.
Maybe the producer was yelling in Hannity's ear.
Yeah.
Shh. 1 minute.
Yeah, Mike Lindell on hold. That's
nice.
All
right.
Can they fix his voice? Like, what?
I mean, if they could fix his voice, I think they would.
I guess so, man. It makes it really hard to listen to during a debate. Again, that's my shallowness.
You actually have to debate like human beings.
Yeah.
You have to give a person a moment to speak.
I wonder if he's somebody that people would talk over, because it would be so obnoxious.
Only Donald Trump.
It would seem so obnoxious to over-talk a guy whose voice is like that. You might actually have to let him finish.
Yeah, I think you would come across worse for interrupting.
You'd come across worse, yeah.
Troy, you still think Lone Gunman?
Yeah, I think so. One lone gun nut.
I'm still a believer in the lone gunman theory.
Yeah.
But I'm open to it. If RFK said something that convinced me, like, this is the guy, and this, I have no...
Does it give you pause that you now know that Bobby Kennedy, his first instinct
I've known
was...
that for years.
Oh.
And I've still thought the same. Mm.
So
but he is right about things not being released, like, and certain information not being released, but I've also heard rational explanations for that, so...
What would it take, though, for you to be like, okay, it wasn't just one lone gunman? Like, yeah, there's something that just is not right in the Warren Commission. What would it take?
I don't know. It's a good question. It's a good question. Because, again, for years I believed it. I really did believe it.
Mm-hmm. Is it possible, though, to believe something else?
Sure.
Okay.
Of course.
What made you change to and go like, you know what? I think there's a lot of bullshit in the conspiracy stuff.
A couple things. Vincent Bugliosi's logical book that he spent 20 years working on, and the way conspiracy theorists react to information that doesn't help them further their cause. I find that they're not looking for an objective truth. That's for me what did it.
You know what's interesting about Bugliosi? Did you read, what was the name of the book? Troy, you actually might know the name of the book. It was about the book that the guy wrote about all the like drug experiments and how the CIA made Charles 60s, Manson. 60s. That a lot of the government LSD experiments in prison.
Chaos.
Right. So this guy. What's
I was
his,
an agent
what's,
of them.
What's the what's the author's name?
Tom O'Neill.
Right. So Tom O'Neill writes this book, Chaos, that he also worked on for like, you know,
Forever, yeah.
Yeah, 40 years or something like that. Yeah. It was supposed to be an article, and it just went on and on. But he talked to Bugliosi about it because it's conflicting with a lot of what's in Helter Skelter. But in it, like the first chapter, he's talking about going to see Bugliosi, sitting in his house. You know, obviously, I think by the time the book came out, Bugliosi had died. But sitting in his house and how mad Bugliosi was and how protective he was about his version of the story.
Sure.
And how he was really upset about anybody trying to conflict his version of the story, and how he was like sitting in the kitchen for hours with Bugliosi, like going over all the details and had all this evidence and trying to like convince him and threatening lawsuits and doing all this stuff. So I only say that to say that like it felt like, at least in that instance, when Bugliosi was like, this is what happened, he was locked in. It wasn't sort of I'm just seeing what happened. It's like, nope, I figured it out, and I'm going to build a case around this, which is what lawyers do.
The only thing I'll think is different about that is that he was so personally invested
because he was
in Manson, because he was prosecutor. Mm-hmm. So any version that came out is almost like one that discredits his work.
True.
As opposed to Kennedy, where it's your detachment because you didn't do it or you're not involved in it.
Unless he's the type of guy who wants it, now that he's writing
sure,
about it,
maybe.
He attaches himself to an argument.
Just reading what I read, though,
mm-hmm.
It was very logical. The
and
way
that's
he
not to take
it.
Any. Obviously, Bugliosi's a credible guy.
It was very, very thorough, mm-hmm. the book. But I mean, that's what did it for me. That and listening to conspiracy theorists try to bridge certain gaps with vagaries and out specifics. It's why I like Mick West and not people that put up UFO videos. The vagaries lose me every time. I can't. Dude, it's just there's so many. That's not an answer.
That's it, Troy.
When he said the fucking Michio Kaku, what are you talking about? Show the math.
Right.
Stop saying things that defy. What does Kaku say? What, the universe is expanding to nirvana. Shut up.
What?
The fuck does that shit mean?
You don't like Kaku anymore?
No.
Kaku's the man. What are you talking
not
about?
Not the fucking man. He's a genius. He's a genius. And he understands string theory. But again, that childlike vagary, we're expanding to nirvana.
Imagine a cookie.
No, I don't want to imagine a cookie, actually. I don't.
I'd rather listen to him than that asshole Neil deGrasse Tyson.
I know you would. But Neil deGrasse Tyson at least...
He sucks.
He at least gives you a real reason. They're both good at speaking to the layman. But Kaku lives in... He delves into, like, fantasy talk. And I don't like it that simplistic. I don't... And again, when Mick West said, what things was this UFO doing that was defying physics? Show me the math.
Yeah.
That's what, yeah, show it. Or shut up.
I think Kaku is maybe a little bit more open to possibilities.
But then he should say that.
He's not locked into a specific set of data that has been presented.
But when you're a theoretical physicist and you're saying something is defying physics... And someone says, what thing showed the math?
Right.
You should immediately be able to do that. That's your job.
Neil deGrasse Tyson is great.
I prefer him to Michio Kaku. Michio Kaku is a brilliant guy.
Right.
He's a brilliant person.
I'm not a fan.
Yeah, I understand.
No?
And that's me talking. I know you guys are friends with him. He comes
like
on the show.
Yeah.
He's a friend of the show. I do not like him, or do I support him?
Or do I support him?
I don't like any. I don't ever press like on any of his stuff. I don't watch any of it. I don't follow him on anything.
If you remember... Troy started eating Steak'em just because they got into a Twitter spat with Neil deGrasse Tyson.
I support Steak'ems.
You do support Steak'ems.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. But you like Kaku?
Love. He was just on Rogan, and he was excellent.
Neil deGrasse Tyson. I've listened to him for hours on. I listened to
Rogan has Neil deGrasse Tyson on, too.
But he's a shithead.
No, I don't think so.
Because he doesn't live in vagary. He demands to.
That's true.
He's very, very specific. And I remember, I used to love Michio Kaku on Art Bell. I would listen to him for 4 hours. I love this guy because he makes you believe, and he's got this amazing, he's a great talker, and he just gives you this hopefulness in the way he speaks. And to say things like, yeah, we're expanding to Nirvana, and that sounds so great, but then you're like, what does that really mean? And then you talk to someone like Neil deGrasse Tyson, he's like, it doesn't mean anything. There's no numbers that support that.
Probably would have liked him on Rogan, though. He's talking about quantum computers. You love quantum computers.
I would love to hear what he says about that. Of course. He's a brilliant guy. It's string theories. I don't say he's not
one of the
genius.
He's creators of string theory.
Dude, his brain is... I read one of his books where I tried to. It was too smart for me.
Mm-hmm.
But I loved what I read of it. It was very interesting. I just wish I was smarter and could understand more of it. I'm not knocking his brain or his ability to talk. I just hate when he goes into things... that as a theoretical physicist, he shouldn't. Like, don't say things like it defies physics. How?
Mm-hmm.
When another bright guy goes, all right, great, show me how that, and you go, hey, and you float away with that fucking positivity shit.
You don't like positivity?
I don't mind it, but I don't want it from a scientist.
Oh.
I don't need a spin, positive or negative, from a scientist.
Uh-huh. Just give me the results.
Yeah.
I get that.
Big Kaku fan.
You like Dr. Kaku?
Love him.
I was too for many years. So. I was, and I still respect him, but I just don't like that part of what he does.
Mm-hmm.
I find it hokey.
Tries to get people like Troy on his side.
I'm on his side.
Yeah. You are?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
John on Staten Island. What's up, John?
How's it going, guys?
Hi,
I read
John.
The Chaos book by Tom O'Neill. And, like, maybe in a little bit of support of the conspiracy theory angle, Bogliosi committed crimes during that prosecution. He knowingly put perjurers on the stands. So it wasn't just, I'm digging into my stance. He had things to cover.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know anything about it.
It's a good book.
It's a pretty interesting book. Like you said, the program you were talking about is MK Ultra.
Mm-hmm.
Where they were dosing people with acid and stuff in the 60s. And one of the people, the scientist that worked on it, Jolly West was the guy's name. He was like the last guy to visit Ruby in prison before he lost his mind.
Ooh.
Jolly West?
Exactly. Yeah, Jolly West. Okay. He's the doctor for the CIA that was administering the LSD in experiments during the MK Ultra program.
All right. Well, thanks, man.
Thank
it's
you.
Good book. A lot of good stuff.
It is a good book. Thank you, dude. What do you think about MK Ultra?
I don't know much about it, to be honest.
Oh, I just saw.
No, the,
I
oh, the reason I
read
no,
a reaction.
The reason I did is because I'll tell you off air why, but there's no reason to that.
Right.
I don't know much about it.
Oh, okay. Troy, you looked into MK Ultra?
Yeah, I mean, a little bit.
Yeah.
Did you read that Chaos book?
I didn't. I
you
should.
You love it. Yeah. You love it.
What year is it from?
It's new.
It is new.
I mean, let's a couple years. Yeah,
but it took him like 20 years to write it.
Yeah.
Yeah, he got assigned to write an article on Manson for like one of the anniversaries, and like just ended up falling into the research hard that like he just kept working.
Took him
on
down
it.
All these avenues.
Yes, yeah. And he worked on it for years and years and years and years and years and years, and finally, boom.
Yeah. Okay.
Here it is. Yeah.
I wish I could commit to a book. Like, I'm so bad at reading now. Like, I just, the attention span is gone. I just wish I was better at it.
You listen to books, though.
Yeah, I haven't in a while, though, now that I'm still fighting tugging my dick. I find that takes a lot of my fucking time.
It does.
It takes away from book time?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, I want to read, but then again, she's showing her cunt.
I get that. I would tell you more about MK Ultra, but I've been tugging. I haven't done the research. Yeah. I get you.
I totally get that.
You understand, right?
100%.
That's where you guys are back. See, you guys hit a fork in the road where you guys went separate, and now you're starting to come back together.
We'll never agree on that. But I mean, as far as understanding certain elements of our own thing, we both get it.
We both understand that tugging is a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And sometimes it distracts you.
It's very distracting. Yeah. And despite wherever you stand politically or on conspiracy, either way, it's hard to commit to a book when the option is an open anus that you can tug your penis to.
I see what you're saying.
That crosses all political and ideological lines.
I totally see what you're
100%
saying.
100%, Jim.
We should take a break and make love.
Okay, let's not fully make love, but we will take a break, and we'll be right back.
Stephen Root.
It's Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Back after this. Here they are. Jim and Sam are back.
Yeah. Welcome back to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts Show. Here on Sirius XM Channel 103, 8 to 11 Eastern Standard Time, Monday through Thursday.
Damn, that's a deep cut.
Yeah.
What is this?
DMV.
DMV by Primus.
I'm off of pork soda.
We never get any Primus.
No.
Yeah. Do today.
I love their version of Electric Funeral from Bonnaroo.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
What a great riff.
I like great Winona's fan. Big Brown Beaver.
Ah, you know what that's about.
I didn't figure that
an
out
animal?
Until much later.
Yep. See, that's what you'd expect, but that's where Travis throws us for a loop.
That's right.
Yeah.
So he knows
this
stuff.
This is good.
Or Mrs. Blayling. Remember Mrs. Blayling?
Maybe not by name, but maybe if I heard it.
It's great.
I got this on Columbia House.
You did?
Did you?
How much did you pay for this album?
This album specifically?
Yeah.
Fraction of a penny.
1/12 of a cent?
Yeah. What year is this?
95,
yeah.
Hey, when you did Columbia House and you got the 12 records for a penny, what albums did you choose when you had to go and pay? To pay for the other ones?
Was that part of the deal? I missed that.
Excuse me, I was wrong. 93.
Yeah, I'm not saying anything, but I was a Columbia House guy myself.
You are. You don't want to say anything.
I bought every one.
Wink, wink.
Yeah.
Oh, I like that.
It was so cool getting CDs in the mail.
Yeah, I never did it.
You never did what?
Columbia House.
That's how you know.
You're such a liar.
What a fucking weenie.
I didn't do Columbia
Sam's
House.
Sam's a weenie.
Did BMG? You never did it.
No.
All right.
No. Oh, good. We have our guest coming in.
Yes.
Otherwise, Travis could call me a big dork.
Yep.
For not ripping off Columbia House like the rest of the cool kids.
Comfortable temperature.
Did you turn it up?
No.
I don't know. That switch is looking pretty high.
Yeah. I literally almost broke my thumb jamming it up.
Well, welcome to the show, Stephen Root.
How are you guys?
Good, how you doing?
Come on in. Sit down.
I'll try.
Barry is, of course... on HBO, new episodes Sunday at 10 p.m.
Yes.
I mean, at this point, you know, actors always talk about being worried about the next project and, you know, I don't know when I'm going to work again and everything. Does it come to a point where you're like, yeah, no, I'll be fine?
Yeah, I think I'll be fine.
Yeah.
I'm like 100 years old now. If you don't know my work at this point, it's like, that's okay. I'll stay home and pet the dog.
Yeah, I did it.
I did it already.
I did it. I'm done.
Fine.
We had Henry Winkler last week, and I'd only seen a few episodes of Barry, but after Henry, I went right back into, like, started from the beginning.
Oh, very cool.
It's so good, man.
It's unbelievable.
It's an unbelievable show.
It's all writing, too. The writing is phenomenal. And then you've got great actors who can improvise, and Bill who can direct the hell out of shit now. So
yeah,
it's awesome.
It's really great. I'm so happy. I'm annoyed that I'm not caught up, but I'm happy
I went back into it.
No,
it's okay. Take your time. There's a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah, it's very funny.
Yeah, it's nice, too, when you go back and you just get to enjoy the show that way, like at your own pace,
mm-hmm.
you know, instead of rushing
through it.
And
it's an easy binge.
Yes.
It's a half hour.
Yes.
You know. You could do a season and like watching two movies.
You're like, I can't. There's no way anybody else has pulled off being on episodes of Succession and Barry back to back.
I think it's my greatest triumph.
That's it. I mean, showing up.
I'll be remembered for that and Office Space, and that's it.
And that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you ever think, right? You're doing news radio for all these years. Playing this character, it's the cornerstone of the show. It should be the Fonz, and then you do something else, and people are like, "No, Milton in Office Space." Like Jimmy James is not the one.
That's it. Are you still doing stuff? Great, I loved Office Space.
Yeah, you're one of those people who's popped up every, like you're in everything. Like you know what I mean? Like there's certain guys that just you're not a character actor. Would you consider yourself that?
I consider myself. Only that. Yeah.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm a character actor, always wanted to be a character actor, and my goal was to be a working actor. And that, you know, that I've been able to do.
Yeah, because the example I always use is a guy like J.T. Walsh.
Sure.
Who people, like his face, like everybody knew J.T. Walsh's face.
Yeah, there's a whole bunch of guys that you love, you don't know their names, but they're great character actors. They can do almost anything. I'm not including myself in that.
No, you should.
But there are a number of unbelievable, and all the guys that I loved, you know, the 30s and 40s, all those guys that you saw in all those films when there was a studio system, because they could come walk in and do, you know, one movie, and then they'd walk over across the lot and do another movie. But those are the guys that I emulated and loved. You know, guys who came from vaudeville, basically.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, do you enjoy the fact that I feel like you're one of those guys that everybody knows you from stuff, but also you're unrecognizable a lot of times from show to show.
That's the thing. You know, you want to delve deep into his character as you can, and it doesn't work unless it's grounded in reality, you know, unless you're that guy in real life, in your head. So...
So even if you're just on for like one scene,
doesn't matter.
You'll figure it out.
Yeah. And I think the ultimate truth in that is seeing all the people who played smaller, tiny roles in Barry. You see through these seasons, beautiful, wonderful actors doing just a tiny bit, and it's like not the size of the role; it's the quality of the scene.
Even in season one, it's very obvious that they will. Remove somebody from the show by killing them. Like they're not afraid to do that. Like
not
there's
afraid,
been a couple
no.
of really good people who I got into very much, and I'm like, I can't believe they just fucking killed that guy.
Yeah. Bill and Alec Berg, great producer that he is, wanted that from the start. So this show is going to walk the tightrope of comedy and real violence, and they're not going to mix. We're never going to mix them. It's going to be violence and it's going to be comedy, but, you know, it's going to be real if it's going to be violent.
Well, they have him doing things. Like one problem shows do is they want someone to be likable so much that they'll only allow them to do an unlikable thing if it's 100% steeped in some kind of a justification. But with Bill, they've had him do a few that you're like, yeah, that was just kind of brutal. Like they've put him in a position where that's not the most fucking likable thing he could have done.
Right.
He just had to kill somebody, so he killed him.
Yeah, well, I mean, he's playing a real character with PTSD, and he's not getting better. And as the season's going, he ain't getting better. So in that sense, I think the naturalistic tone of the show works. You know, these are real people, and he's fucked up.
Yeah.
Have you, when you're trying to figure out what a character or who a character is? Because you've done, like, Milton is a good example of somebody who that's not necessarily all on the page, right? Like, yeah. you're, and you can sometimes go out there,
yeah,
with these characters. Have you had any that a director has been like, not quite that, like, bring it in, or are your instincts really good?
Just for the Milton thing, we had been doing King of the Hill in the Fox Lot,
right?
And Mike wrote this movie. And so he got like four or five of us, said, the network wants to read it. Can we, you want to go over and read it? And said, okay. And Mike said, I'm going to read Milton, and you're going to do, I don't know what, the guy who dies while he's the psychiatrist. What?
Yeah.
Okay. You do him, you do one of the Bobs, you know, whatever. And I said, okay, great. And then on the walk over, he said, I just want to watch it. You do, Milton. I said, thanks for the prep. And he showed me the 2-minute pencil sketch that he had voiced. And I said, well, I want to take him into a more, I want to give him a lisp, a tiny lisp, and soft, you know, soft and not a big guy. And that's the way we went for that. So, yeah, I gave him my gut read of it. And you have to give your gut of stuff like that, and then that's the director's job to say, yeah, maybe, but maybe if you go this way too, you know. So it's happened many times in my career.
Yeah.
Do you find sometimes that they think they know what they're looking for, like in a, right, a breakdown for an audition? They'll say, well, we want this and that.
News Radio. Paul Simms was looking for WKRP, a guy 10 years older than me. He was looking for that, and I came in and I said, Mom, I'm not, you know, let me do, bend him this way, you know, bend him, make him a little more mysterious, and then
eccentric.
Paul wrote to that, and then Paul wrote to that. So, yeah, you give your gut, and then, you know, hopefully that works out.
What they put down in a description is not always, like, if you, when you show them something different, they might be, oh yeah, that's what,
oh,
I actually want.
I like that better.
That's better.
Yeah.
I think my favorite Jimmy James twist was him revealing that he was indeed D.B. Cooper. That was probably...
I love the D.B. Cooper. I do.
With the parachute and everything on it.
I do remember being in jail with Andy. that was an interesting time.
I would imagine. Have you ever read for a Stephen Root type? Like, have you ever seen...
I've seen that in breakdowns. I think they even had that in Barry because they weren't... Henry and I were the last ones cast on that show.
Wow.
They were looking, they hadn't decided whether or not they wanted a contemporary for Bill or, you know, like an older guy. Mm-hmm. And when they finally thought of me, I think it was like a Steve Root type. And hello, I'm available.
Is there anything you've turned down that, like, I'm always fascinated by roles that people turn down
that
become amazing and you're like, do you wish you had done it, or do you think it wouldn't have been the same if you had done it?
I've never experienced where I wish I would have had that role. I've had a lot of experiences of not being able to do roles because I'm doing another role.
Right.
But
I've never had that experience.
Yeah.
You have not.
No, lucky me. But yeah. No, not really. There's nothing I've coveted that I think I should have done that role that I can think of offhand. No, I've been lucky enough to have a lot of singular opportunities to do stuff that's well written.
Yeah. Isn't it nice jumping in, like, doing 3 or 4 different shows a year, and, like, just, you're not getting stuck in one place if you don't want to be stuck in one place.
Yeah, there's a lot of people who do. You know, they have a strength and they want to do that, and that's what they do for their career. But that's not a character actor to me. I mean, I always want to be different. If I'm doing West Wing, then I want to do Dodgeball right after that. You know, I want to mix it up as much as I can, because that's interesting for me. That's not necessarily true of all actors.
Well, it's also, like, super interesting to me with you that it goes back to you not being necessarily recognized, is that even in something like Dodgeball, which is a comedy, as is News Radio, as is Office Space, it takes you a second before you realize, wait, that's the same.
Different guy. Yeah.
It's the same actor. It's the same person. I mean, do you feel any type of way about watching yourself back?
Once.
You've only watched yourself back once?
No,
you
I'm
will
saying,
watch it
I will
once.
Watch it once. And some stuff I won't watch once. It's too weird because I think probably many actors say, you know, I wish they would have used another take rather than that one.
So then what do you watch? You're in everything. So like what's...
I watch all the good shows like Succession. Yeah, I know. I was in it for a second. But no.
You just have to start skipping scenes on like every sitcom
that's ever existed. Now? Diplomat. Have you seen that?
Yes, I've heard of it.
She's amazing in it. And Rufus Sewell, who was her husband in it, I worked with in Man in the High Castle. He was the head Nazi. And he is unbelievable. I really think that's one of those shows that is super well written, kind of like West Wing meets Newsroom meets, you know, stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you find that people who enjoy watching themselves, like, 'cause I've known people like that, like, I hate watching myself, and I know people who are like, guys, I'm on.
And I'm, Why aren't you? Yeah.
I don't know how they fucking do it. Like, it's humiliating.
It's too much. It's too much.
Are you more comfortable doing it alone or in front of other people watching?
Oh, my gosh. I'd much rather be alone.
Yeah.
And see it first. And then if I have to see it, like, for a premiere or something else, then it's like, okay, I've seen the worst, and I can get through it.
I want people to be able to react naturally. Like, I never want to feel like they're reacting because I'm in the room or,
right, exactly.
or to be polite.
Sure. I get that 100%. My wife hates being watching herself even more than I do. She's a great character actor as well. She actually got on to a Barry. She played Sarah's mom in the episodes when she goes to see her mom and dad.
So that's the one episode that's banned from your household entirely. Yeah.
Will not watch it, even though she's brilliant in it.
Yeah. Is there anything you've been on that you're like, you know, if it wasn't for the fact that I'm in this, I could probably really enjoy watching this?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
You ruin things for yourself by acting in them.
It's like, oh, him. No, it's a good piece of work is a good piece of work, and
yeah,
enjoy it all.
Did you like doing news radio in the sense that it lasted multiple seasons and you were on every episode, or do you, or you know, even movies that you've done where you're a huge part of them, or do you get antsy doing anything?
It depends on where you are in your career. At the time I was doing news radio, I would very much wanted to be on a show, you know, because I had a kid and I had to make a living.
Yes.
The fact that it turned out to be a magic show, which, you know, there's a couple that you get, was a lanyap. You know, I got to do it for 5 years with amazing people. But at that time, I really wanted to be on a show. In my life now, do I want to sign a 7-year contract? Probably not.
Right.
You know, I want to jump, enjoy jumping into small indies. I'm going to do a bigger film in London this year and then come back and do some maybe TV stuff. But yeah, I like jumping around now because, you know, there's only so much time you got to play on Earth here.
Yeah, and you can.
In this body.
Yes.
So, okay, let's go do it.
Yeah.
At what point did you get confident enough to feel that way? Like, how far into it? What was the thing where you went, yeah, I'm going to be fine if I'm not doing this?
Probably after news radio, I felt like I was a well-known enough commodity, not to an audience, but to casting directors.
Okay. Mm.
So they knew the work, and I figured, if nothing else, I can get in there and try for it.
You still have to read?
I haven't for a while, but would I? Yeah. I mean, Bill wanted me to come in, and Henry, to come in and say, this is not an audition, but would you show us what you would want to do with this? And we said, yeah, of course we do. We want to see if we're on the same page with you. So we both came in and did that. So it was not really an audition, but I don't do, you know, straight auditions anymore, except for a lot of voiceover staples that I never get.
Really?
I don't get Chevrolet. I don't get those kind of spokes jobs. Yeah. But I try to get them every once in a while. But that's the only audition I do is for voiceover stuff.
I like the idea of not auditioning because you won't get it if you audition. If you don't audition, you'll be fine.
Yes. Or if you audition, you've knocked yourself out of the job.
Yeah.
I wouldn't do table reads. I've been cast on a few things, never anything long term, but I would never do table reads because I was convinced I was going to be fired. So I would always avoid them.
Yeah, you could lose a job in a table read.
What's that?
You could lose a job in a table read.
Oh, yes, you can. I've heard of it happening.
Easily.
Oh, that's terrifying.
I've heard that happening quite a few times.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's no security.
No.
It's like, I got the job. No, you didn't.
Welcome to the business.
After, we talked to someone not long ago who that happened to, where they said it was the table read, and it just, they could feel that they were bombing. Like, they just knew that they weren't in sync with the cast, and then afterwards they found, well, it might have been a comedy.
Ready? Ready for this? Table read of news radio. Mm-hmm. Who was the part that played Joe Rogan? Raymond.
Ray Romano.
Ray Romano.
Really?
Ray Romano was playing Joe's part.
He was cast originally?
He was cast. He did the, I don't know if he was cast. We were doing the table read. I think he was. Did the table read. And everybody's, you know, this is a fast group. And Ray is, well, da-da. You know, his speed was different than what probably this show would go. So they let him go. And, wow. And we got Joe.
And Joe comes in.
Yeah.
And then Ray went on to obscurity.
It's the best thing that ever happened to him.
Yeah.
And yeah. Joe. Like, isn't it crazy how that worked out? Like,
yeah, Ray will tell you that. He's so happy that I wasn't on that show.
That it didn't happen. Yeah. I'm sure in the moment it's like soul crushing. And then you just give it a little bit of time. And you're like, oh, yeah, I guess I'll do my own.
Wait a minute.
Show.
I have my own show. Lovely.
Then Letterman can discover him, like, you know, as opposed to having been on that show first. But it just seems in that moment that's probably so embarrassing and crushing.
It's so weird. Yeah. It's so weird.
When you get kicked off.
It's happened to all of us, and it's just part of the business.
Yeah. Do you just develop that? Do you just develop a thick skin where you're like, this is
hopefully.
Just.
Hopefully. Yeah.
This is just. But does that mean you can't enjoy the successes quite as much because. You just can't allow yourself to get that invested?
No, when you're standing on the soundstage doing the lines, then I have the job.
Right.
But only until then.
Right.
I don't believe it until then.
Wow. I don't believe I'm not going to be cut out until it airs. Okay.
That's true, too.
Have you been cut out of anything?
I did 5 scenes with Arnold in Kindergarten Cop.
Wow.
5 scenes. And he said to me in the chair, "You are so fucking funny." And I got completely cut out of that movie.
Wow.
Completely cut out of that movie.
Did they ever tell you why?
I have an elbow in it.
Oh, that's nice.
An elbow.
It's more than I've gotten in a normal movie. Did they tell you why they cut you?
The movie started afterwards, and they didn't need the subplot. Which I get. That's happened to me in several. Another movie, same thing. Had scenes at the beginning, but they decided they didn't need the subplot.
And that's another thing that you have to condition yourself to be okay with, right?
White Oleander,
It's not about me.
Nope.
It's not my performance.
Nope.
It's not anything. It's just that character.
That character
doesn't need to exist.
And time.
Yeah.
We have this much time for this movie.
Wasn't there a captain? Is it Captain January or something? An Apocalypse? No, Full Metal Jacket, who had a bunch of scenes and
was just totally cut out.
It was like a co-lead or something in a Kubrick film, and the whole character was just removed.
Oh.
I don't remember why it happened. Maybe it was for time, or maybe it just didn't fit.
Oh, it happens all the time.
Yeah.
All the time.
I've had scenes cut, but I've never had a subplot. Like, that's, you know.
A whole subplot with many scenes cut out, yeah.
No. How do they let you know?
If the director doesn't call you, that's bad forms. But the directors always call you.
I didn't get called. I found out when we were doing ADR.
Really?
Yeah, it was like, this is going to be in the director's version. I'm like, oh.
That's nice.
Yeah.
How much residuals do I get from that?
Yeah. Wow. Shitty way to find out.
Crazy. Yeah.
Crazy.
Yeah. Have you ever had to do anything where you're like, you know what, I got to stop taking certain types of roles for a while.
Yeah.
Because people are hitting me in this one direction.
I did a sitcom right after I did news radio called Ladies Man with one of the greatest casts ever, but it was kind of not well done.
Mm.
It was, the writing was not good. Get this cast. Me, Betty White, Sharon Lawrence, Kaylee Cuoco, when she was 16.
Wow.
And one other person, but oh my God, it was an incredible, incredible cast, and it just wasn't well written. And wait, I forgot the main guy, Alfred Molina.
Wow,
I love Alfred.
Fred Molina was the lead of that show, and all these other people. It lasted a year and a half.
Wow, yeah,
that was it.
And then at the
end of that, to get to your question, the end of that, I said, I got to get out of comedy land for a while.
Yeah.
So I waited and took, you know, guest starring roles on Our Dramatics until I got a recurring on West Wing.
It's awful to have to deliver lines that aren't funny when someone else writes them and you know this.
You know it's bad.
Stinks.
Especially yeah. you're coming funny. Off a, like a brilliant show. Yeah. Like yeah. you know, is this bad? You know it's bad because you're yeah. just on
you know
something
it's bad
really
they
good.
They tell you to push harder. They tell you to push harder, and it's like, I can do that for you, but it's gonna blow.
Yeah,
that's why yeah, Barry yeah. must be so nice because it's like there's so many great. It's legitimately funny. Like, I never laugh watching shit, and I laugh out loud watching the show. It's so mm-hmm. goddamn funny.
Yeah, it is.
It's got to be nice to be on something where you have complete faith in the writing.
Absolutely, it's heaven. As I say, you get a couple of heaven jobs in your career, and this is one.
Does your agent start to panic when you go like, yeah, I don't want, like, I know that all these like sitcoms want me to do this type of
this
thing.
This guy, they want me to be a boss on a show.
So right, man, right.
I don't want to do that. No, they didn't freak out.
They get it.
They got it for me.
Yeah.
So I was lucky in that respect.
Yeah. And do you, was there any point where you start to panic a little bit going like, man, I thought that the big dramatic role would come sooner than this. Or...
You know what? I had a balloon, which was King of the Hill.
Of course.
I had a balloon.
Of course.
So I could survive
yes.
for a while without, you know, having to take stuff. So I consider myself very lucky for that.
That is.
Yeah.
Especially when it's stuff you like.
Yeah.
Like, so many people have to do something that you hear years later, like, I was fucking miserable the whole time I was doing that. And
yeah.
It's nice to make the money, but it just...
It's everybody has to make a living, but, you know, so...
Did you realize, like, was the success of Dodgeball a surprise to you? In the only
No,
in the,
I thought it was a funny script.
It was great. It's
yeah.
like, but just in the sense that the pitch is like, no, it's based around professional dodgeball, like competitive dodgeball. Like, no matter what the cast is,
yeah.
Ben Stiller and Vince Vaughn, and, like, yeah. it does end up being a comedy classic.
Yeah.
But, like, I always think about movies like that, like, at the ground stage. How do you get it off?
Yeah, well, this was a first-time director. I think it was Vince's first really big movie. He'd done a lot of indies, like the smaller ones. But
Swingers and stuff
yes,
like that. Yeah,
Swingers and stuff, but he hadn't done a huge movie. And that was, I think, the first huge movie for him. It was the first...
Right, because it was right after Old School, right, where he had kind of been the side. Yes,
yeah.
Now he's the lead.
So, and I wasn't a name, and, you know, half the people in that weren't.
Yeah.
Weren't. Justin was, you know, had done one other movie.
That's right.
Than I had done, and you know, yeah. So yeah, but I thought the script was funny, and I told Ben I want to do Rick Moranis, and that's what I did.
That's great.
Have you directed anything?
I haven't. That's not something that I'm. You know, that's not my type A personality type of thing. I like putting people together. I'd like to produce something, and I've pitched some shows as a producer, but directing doesn't hold it for me. I enjoy being character actor too much.
When you see actors directing, you wonder if it's just at a point where, like, because you guys know what's working, what's not working, you can feel it, and enough times of having a director give direction that you go, this is idiotic, that it's got to make people just want to go, I just want to direct it. I know what I'm doing.
Sure, I think that happens to a lot of people. It happened to Pamela Adlon on Better Things. She said, I'm tired of being an actor doing shitty stuff. I'm going to write, produce, direct. And that's what she did with that show. And I think that happens to a lot of people. And that's why Bill Wanted came to town. He didn't come to town to do Saturday Night Live. He came into town to be a director. And they pulled him into that, and he got to do all that. But that's not why he came to town.
And he directs every episode of Barrett, which is, it's crazy to act in it and direct it. Like, does he have to watch back after every take? Is he
yeah,
watching?
He'll yeah. run back. He'll maybe do two takes. Maybe. And he'll run back to Alec or whoever's in the chair and go, was that good enough? and then go on. Yeah. Now, he takes his acting seriously, obviously, because he's great at it. But yeah, he doesn't give himself much time to act as much time as he takes to direct.
When you talk about writers and directors, how great was it when you realized, oh, the Coen brothers enjoy casting me in things? This is good.
I was a huge fan of their stuff well before I did my first one, and a huge fan of John Goodman's, who did a lot of their stuff as well. So when I got to, it was a straight audition for Oh Brother Where Art Thou, and I did that for them, and then they were able to put me in some other stuff after that.
Yeah,
but I don't know, I just enjoy their dark, like Barry, sense of humor.
Yeah, and it's original too. Like Barry is like, I think one of the reasons Barry is so great is not just because it's hilarious, but also because it's clearly an original take. Like this is a guy's vision. I feel like Old Brother and everything the Coen brothers do, it's like there's a purpose here.
Oh, yeah.
This is what they wanted to make.
Oh, they storyboarded most of their stuff to the nth degree. Not that they wouldn't throw out something if they said, nah, I don't want to do that. But they all had their storyboards for every film, very, very particular.
Do you like working with directors that are particular like that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they know what they're doing. And this whole season of Barry, mm-hmm. his was Bill's vision of 8 episodes. And that was almost easier to do than the other seasons with other directors, because you could short speak it. You knew exactly what he wanted, and we would finish early almost every day.
That's great.
Yeah.
And also, I'm sure by season 4, he knows exactly what he wants, but he knows exactly what he wants from all of you. He trusts you to do your thing. He's not asking you to do weird.
And then nudge it
if
he wants.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there anything worse than something that looks really good on paper, or it's a great concept and it's just ruined by people who are not performing in it? Like there are things that get ruined behind the scenes by people, the editing or the, no, it's gotta be this way, it's gotta be that way, and you're like, that's just not good.
Yeah, well, it's an editor's medium. So, you know, I give all to them and the writers. But I think what's really wrong these days is there's no more in-room casting. So you can't, when these people send in their tape, that they tape themselves, you're not able to see whether they can be directed, whether they can do, whether the, you can, director could say, yeah, but go this way and that, and they'll go, what?
Yeah.
But I did it this way. You know, you've lost that, to be able to get a role in a room.
Yeah.
You've lost it. You can't.
It's like finding out
your personality. Do you want to work with this guy for 3 years? Or is he an asshole?
Is he coachable?
Yeah, is he coachable? Yeah. And you've lost all that now. So I'm...
And when you're sending it in on tape, you're doing it 40 times.
Yeah.
And sending the best one. We're in a room. You don't have 40
times
to do
it. You don't have that luxury.
Which is why I've gotten a couple things on tape.
Moment. Yeah. But yeah, I think that's a detriment to what's happening these days in terms of casting. Because, yeah, you can do it right after 40 times once, but... Can you get in the studio and then do it right on the day?
Yeah, I never thought of that. Can someone be directed? If someone is doing something wrong, will they be able to adjust or adapt on the fly?
It's a big deal.
Yeah. If you can, how much improvising do you guys do on that?
On
Barry.
On Barry, everything was scripted, but Bill would come in someday and say, "I don't want to say that. What do you want to say?" And that would happen a lot, but they were all improv artists. I wasn't. I came straight from National Shakespeare Company doing plays in New York and doing I came from that background. I didn't come from, so it was originally much more difficult for me to go just play the character and let him go. You know, I wasn't used to doing improv, so it was a learned thing for me through the 4 seasons. I could do it by the end, but you know, it was interesting for me. It's something I learned as an actor.
So you do pretty well, like West Wing was pretty to the...
Oh, yeah. I mean, no, if you missed an and or a but,
uh-huh.
then you did it again.
Right.
Yeah. Who wrote that? Was that Aaron Sorkin?
Yeah.
Oh, he's known for like wanting every single word. Exactly.
Yeah, my goodness. I did a couple of newsrooms as well. It's like very stickler for exactly.
For the words.
For the words.
You can't, there's no room to maneuver.
Mm-hmm.
But you're good with that.
Yeah, I'm completely fine with that. Because again, that's a vision. It's a writer's vision, but it's the vision of exactly what you want to do.
Yeah.
So that I'm fine with that.
And Sorkin's vision has
been proven to be
pretty
he's
good.
He's done pretty well.
He's done all right.
Yeah.
He's done all right.
Is he the funniest guy? Maybe not. But he's done very well.
Well, look, Barry, of course, if you guys aren't watching it already, I don't know what you're waiting for.
It's fucking great, man.
It's incredible.
A really, really good show.
Guys, I appreciate it.
Sundays at 10 p.m. on HBO. Of course, if you have HBO Max, you can binge the whole thing. See if you can binge it all by this Sunday to be caught up to the new episode.
Oh, I can't wait for people to see episode 6 of this show.
Yeah.
Because it's, you know, all the seasons go left turn.
Yes.
And this one is going to do that as well.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Congratulations. Such a great show, man.
We're fans. Steven Root, you're the best.
Yep. Tonight, Fat Black Pussycat, 7 o'clock. I'll be doing my hour. Come if you wish.
Yes. We'll be back tomorrow. See ya.
This has been Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Listen whenever you want with the SiriusXM app. Free for most subscribers. Download it today and start listening outside the car.